Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome back Bob Weeks.
Morning, everybody. How's everyone doing? Everybody have a good day yesterday? Wasn't Jerry Yang fabulous last night, and the dinner was good? We have another half a day today packed with all sorts of information. Just before we get started, though, with our first panel, a couple of housekeeping notes. If you don't already know, the Wi-Fi is Marriott Conference, and the password is golf if you want to log on. That's the only way, by the way. The app is the only way we're asking questions still again today. If you have a question for any of our panelists during the course of the day, please just type it in and we'll get it up here and we'll try to fit them in. We're on, again, I'm the manager of clock integrity again today. We have to get through here in time. And but that's the way to ask questions. Well, hopefully we get them up. We have one break during the day, and during that break, also our kiosks will be out and manned in the lobby out there. There are three different kiosks with some really good information if you have a chance and want to ask some questions to the people who are behind all those things that you saw yesterday. Also, at the end of today, if you're sticking around tonight, from 3 to 7 at 1 Under, that's an indoor driving range golf facility here, just walking distance from 3 to 7, there's going to be some good fun. There's some drinks, some food. So if you want to socialize again, if you're not heading home perhaps till later or till tomorrow, please join us over there. And there's directions on the app of how to get there. In fact, I think there's a map actually on there. You could just follow along as the dot moves. All right, without further ado, we'd like to get started today. And we talked a lot about yesterday about innovation, but innovation doesn't always just occur with technology and on the golf course. It also occurs in leadership. And so we've asked three leaders from our host golf federations to come up today and talk a little bit about that. And without further ado, here is John Bodenhammer of the USGA, Roland DeVoe of Golf Canada, and Federico Valdez of the Mexican Golf Federation. Welcome, gents.
It's good.
Just make yourself comfortable.
Should I come here?
Sure.
Get the furthest away? Okay, I'll come over here and sit down with you guys too. Make you feel cozy. There we go. I'll leave one seat just in case you guys start getting mad at me. As I mentioned, innovation occurs in leadership and in governance, and that's what we want to talk about. You three are very well versed in all this. And Federico, why don't we start with Mexico and talk a little bit about some of the changes that have occurred there over the last couple of years, really as a result of some of the international competitions and things that have gone on. And just give us a rundown of what it's like in Mexico now for international competition.
Well, thank you. Good morning, everyone. It seems like, not seems like it, it's, Mexico has been in the news and in the good sense of the world, golf news, thanks to the WGC that has been played last week in Mexico City, including the Chapultepec. And I would say, for starters, that that's kind of it represents, in the whole sense of the word, in many ways, what's the situation here in Mexico in golf sense and golf-wise. We have been hosting international competitions in the last couple of years. We've hosted PGA Tour events the last 10 years in Mayakoba Golf Classic, and the OHL Classic at Mayakoba later in the last 5 years. And we hosted the Central and Caribbean Games in 2014, where golf actually participated again and after many years of not being part of the competition. Only last year, 2016, we hosted the Junior America's Cup, and we hosted the World Amateur Team Championships. So the World Amateur Team Championships also, it was kind of the pinnacle of our efforts in promoting golf in Mexico as a country and hosting the world of golf internationally in our country. The site for this World Amateur was Cancun Riviera Maya. Especially in Riviera Maya, we played two beautiful golf courses, the Mayakoba and El Camaleon and Iberostar. And for personally, the World Amateur Team Championship was a life project. I've been working for the Mexican Golf Federation for the last 8 years, and the last six, I've been focusing mostly in the World Amateur Team Championship as part of my work and responsibility. So after many years of hard work and basically I mean, we did it because we love the game so much, and we actually wanted to give back at least a little bit of what we have been receiving from the golf community all around the world. And we tried to, 50 years after the first time we hosted the event, we tried to show the golf community, especially the amateur golfers and World Golf Federations, that that we have something to offer, and it's high quality, and the country, regardless of the bad publicity that we have receiving for the last few years regarding security and stuff, we showed quite some people about the possibilities of actually coming to Mexico and playing golf in Mexico with very high quality golf courses, and what I think was a first class event. So so that's pretty much what the Mexico Golf Federation has been working in the last few years.
How does it now play out? You're obviously it leads into bigger things such as the Olympics. Has that been a big part of your focus?
Sure. The Olympics for golf and for Mexico has represented in many ways mostly mainly good things, specifically federal funding from the government. The Mexican government has very, very specific policy regarding supporting sports that actually have participation in the Olympics. And since golf was included in this Olympic program since, I think it was 2009 when it was announced, and we started working with the federal government and the National Olympic Committee, our Mexican Olympic Committee, towards Rio and towards golf going back to the Olympics. For us, it's not only about the Olympics. Fortunately, we started in 2014 with the Nanjing Youth Olympic Games. Then we hosted, as I was telling you, the in Veracruz, the Central and Caribbean Games. Then we came to we participated in Toronto in the Pan American Games, and then by the time that we actually arrived to Rio, we had done our homework and actually learned a lot from these new relationships between the Mexican Golf Federation, the government, the Olympic Committee, the Ministry of Sports, that we were actually first timers in all of the sense of the word, trying to get ready for such an important event as the Olympic Games are. So so we participated in the Olympics with three athletes, two ladies and one player, one man, and they did well. Some say they could have done better.
they always say do that. Better, Federico. Always do better.
Yeah, they can always do better. But we're very pleased. Actually, having three players represent Mexico in the Olympics was a huge success for us.
Since that time now, what's gone into in terms of player development in Mexico? Where do you see that going?
Well, we're here is the Mexican team for the World Amateur Team Championship. From the left is Maria Fassi, then Ana Paula Valdez, Isabella Fierro, then Marcela Coglan, which was a coach for the team, and Dolores, which was she was until recently the president of the Women's Mexican Golf Association. We have very high hopes on our players. We are working very hard in growing the program. Raising funds for the Mexican team isn't easy, so we are trying to innovate. Actually, we're rebranding our national teams under a private initiative to actually make it easier for us to raise funds. The federal government has changed its policy regarding supporting national teams in every sport, so we are trying to accommodate them with a solution that best represents the interest of the federal government in supporting private initiatives for players like these three girls. In the near future, we are hoping that we should be able to offer Mexican golf the best possible players, amateur and professional, to represent Mexico in all of the competitions that we can participate. And just in particular from this picture, I can showcase Isabella Fierro, the smaller one. She won the Mexican, the women's Mexican amateur and the South American amateur in almost consecutive weeks. So she's playing really hard and she's 15. So we have very high hopes for her. She will eventually go to college as we have many players going to. And in the men's side, we are hoping that some of our players will actually recover their PGA status as they had a couple of years ago. So another example, for example, Roberto Diaz, who played the WGC last week, he won a gold medal in the Central Caribbean Games in 2014. So we're getting there. I mean, we'll eventually have enough money. There's never enough money, I know. But we will eventually have more money to offer these players the possibility of actually competing against the best and continue to compete against the best. And hopefully we will have much better results from them and them actually becoming better persons and better players.
Great. Thank you, Federico. Roland, let's move on to Golf Canada. And Golf Canada has, I think many people may know the top line story, but they don't really know what goes on behind. That you've really transitioned from being just a golf association to being an NSO, a national sports organization. And I guess maybe the first thing is, you know, how has the role changed? Can you kind of define and tell us what that means?
Well, we have a long storied history back to 1895, but we knew how to run tournaments, great tournaments. We knew how to do rules and handicapping and course rating. But in 2005, we were designated by the federal government as the national sport organization. And as a result of that, even though we have a lot of partners in the in the industry, in the golf industry, and the sport, 2005 opened up a brand new world for us. And you can see on the screen, what that means. Essentially, as a national sport organization, you're designated as the body that's going to administer the sport in the country. So it's up to you to lead and collaborate with all the partners in the sport to push the principles that you as a sport organization is responsible for and responsible to government for. There is funding, but there's also a lot of accountability. So combined with that, you'll see in the top right-hand corner there, obviously, if you go back just one slide, as Federico mentioned, it also comes with being in the Olympics, which is a great privilege, but it's also a great responsibility. And the bottom left, one of our other partners in terms of our role in the sport is on the podium. And when you're in Canada, they take their Olympics pretty seriously here. And when you're a sport organization, you're not expected to do your best at the Olympics. You're expected to come back with a medal. So that group, in terms of on the podium, is. You're totally accountable to go to the Olympics and win a medal. Now, having said that, obviously, two of the most important objectives of a sport organization is participation and excellence. And Olympics, obviously, it's a great event, but it is about the medals. But what we found as a sport organization was that it really it had great benefits in terms of participation in two ways. First, Olympics create heroes, and we saw that last year with our four two men and two ladies that represented us in Rio. They were national heroes, and those types of heroes drive participation at the grassroots, and that's really important. And the other way it drives participation is when you've got the Olympics, on the worldwide stage, you introduce the sport to people who've never, particularly golf, who had been, had been out of the Olympics for over 100 years, and Canada, incidentally, was the defending champion.
Had a long run.
Had a long run. it just opens up the world to people who've never seen golf. So that was just another benefit of driving that. So as a result of that, if you go to the next slide, you'll see the what we had to do as a national sport organization was to to go back to fundamentals and develop a strategic plan based on our role. We had to do that using basically the four principles, and we call it our house, Gulf Canada House here, and you'll see there are four pillars. And the pillars are related specifically to our role as a national sport organization with Sport Canada, and they are growing participation in the game, ensuring excellence in terms of our elite players and officials, expanding capacity, again ensuring that we can service the sport, that there's sustainable funding and fiscal responsibility in the sport, and finally to foster interaction. And of course, you know, we've got a lot of partners. We've got over 60 associations that we deal with in terms of administering the sport. So you know, that interaction is there. So again, you know, in our previous role, we were basically, you know, we were an association that ran tournaments, but now it's a much deeper responsibility, and one we're very proud of is Golf in Schools and Future Links, which is our long, you know, involves our long-term player development program. Golf in Schools has each year 370,000 kids that we introduce to the game. Over 3,100 schools across Canada, so we're really proud of it, and it's all based on, again, the sport development aspect of it. Player development was in June last year, and just happened to a gentleman from the Chinese Golf Association came up to me and said, you know, we took some of your player development program on the website that you had there. So it's a scary proposition. We've got 1.3 billion people now who are using part of our player development program. So that's pretty cool.
I hope we got some royalties. Did you want to talk about the provincial partners here we've got?
So another aspect in terms of when we talk about governance and innovation in governance is we've got, obviously, we're a national sport organization, and we do have, obviously, as I mentioned, a lot of partners in the industry. But in terms of the provinces, there are 10 provinces, and we have to deal with, you know, we're responsible for the sport. But a lot of the program delivery is actually done at the provinces. So one of the things we've worked on and something, and that includes whether it's championships or player development, but what we've done just this past year in terms of innovation is we said, you know, how can we better deliver programs and services. So we've actually gone first principles first in terms of governance. What is the strategic plan? We've taken the common elements of what our strategic plans are and put them, you know, we've agreed to what they are, and now we're going to focus on delivery and determining what are the appropriate roles and responsibilities for the national bodies and the provincial bodies. So that's something that's actually quite new, and we're quite proud of it. Now, you know, finally, in terms of innovation and governance, an important element of our responsibility as a national sport organization is golfers with disabilities, it's something that's really gaining a foothold and something that we take very seriously at Golf Canada. You know, we've had some individuals in the past. This was actually Brian McLeod from my home province in Nova Scotia, twice runner-up in the World Blind Golf Championships. He captured 67 of 100 of the tournaments he played nationally and internationally. But these people are passionate about golf, no less than we are. And I know John's going to talk more about it, but it's very important that we make our sport accessible to them because they really enjoy the sport. If you go to the next slide, an important initiative that we've just announced implemented is a relationship with the Special Olympics. Special Olympics Canada, we are actually, this year we'll be, they will be participating in some competitions at our courses that we are holding championships at. And actually golf is the very first sport in Canada that's developed a training manual for coaches in terms of the Special Olympics. So we're proud of that, and sort of the, you know, the cutting edge of what's going on in innovation.
Perfect. Thank you, Roland. Moving on to talk about a little bit more about golfers with disabilities, John, I know this is an important part of the USGA's look forward as well.
It is, Bob. Before I move to that, I would like to just say something that just kind of dawns on me sitting up here with Roland and Federico and seeing all that's happening these couple of days. It is quite symbolic that our three organizations are together to stage this symposium. And you think about societal changes that are impacting all of us. Globalization's bringing us closer together. Technology's putting information at our fingertips like never before. More and more women throughout golf are empowered to make financial decisions. I mean, there's more and more and more, but what has become apparent to all of us within the USGA that borders don't really mean a whole lot in the game of golf. And I think working together with our friends in Mexico and Canada is critically important to us at the USGA because we think we can make great strides together throughout the continent. And so we think it's important to be here. And this is just one. As Roland mentioned, let me just say a few things. I saw when we opened the conference yesterday, that opening video, I wrote down a couple of things. It said, in referring to innovation, challenging the norms and asking what can be. And it reminded me of one of my favorite quotes that I keep very close in my office and have for many years, and it was something Robert F. Kennedy said many years ago that I've taken great inspiration from regarding innovation. He said, there are those that look at things the way that they are and ask why. I dream of things that never were and ask why not. I think that's so powerful, and I think it speaks to much of what we're trying to do in the game and in society. And at the USGA, these days, we're asking a lot of ourselves, and why not? And this first slide it speaks to one of those things, how we're innovating with regard to golfers with disabilities. And if you go to the next slide, I'd like to share a little bit more of that thinking with you. That previous slide was Dennis Walters, by the way, if some of you might have recognized him. He's a really wonderful individual that puts on an amazing exhibition if you have a chance to see him as a golfer with disabilities. In looking at this community in America, in the United States of America, it is really quite amazing. In our desire to be inclusive and innovate, we looked at 60 million Americans with a disability of one sort or another, and 10% of those are estimated to play golf. 6 million of those play golf. Quite remarkable. And that number is growing pretty quickly. So at our annual meeting a few weeks ago, we put our stake in the ground. We made a commitment to really embrace this community in a strong way. And by 2020, we are committed, if not sooner, to create a new national championship, USGA National Championship for golfers with disabilities, for men and women of every age, of every background, amateurs, and perhaps even professionals. And we are excited about it. And what is our objective? Our single objective is to inspire the game and this community. USGA Championships, we think, have done that over the years, whether you look at our Public Links Championship when it started in the 20s and how the public game grew, our Junior Championships, and even the Senior Open, how it inspired the senior game in our country. And now next year we'll start our new U.S. Senior Women's Open, which we hope will greatly inspire the women's game. But our objectives are simply to inspire and encourage this community to participate in growing the game, to compete and give them a competitive opportunities, and to provide an on-ramp and avenues to the finest golfers within this community to compete, hopefully by 2024, in golf in the Paralympics. That's a intentional goal of ours. We are an advocate of golf being included in the Paralympics, and we hope that happens in 2024, and this is one step along that route. We also have a governance responsibility that we think is very important. Back in the mid-1990s, the USGA drafted what are the modified rules of golf for golfers with disabilities. And our recent announcement about the rules modernization of the playing rules, it's not our only modernization project. You'll see that a couple of other examples in a minute, but we are modernizing those modified rules, and I'll share with you why. Right now, those modified rules have five categories. Golfers that are amputees, blind, use wheelchairs or canes and crutches, or have an intellectual disability. We're going to modernize that. We're going to think about what that should look like as we go forward. We're going to think about what equipment might need to look like and how the rules should cover that for golfers with disabilities in our governance role. And we're going to create categories that will ladder up into the Paralympics, working with the International Golf Federation to do that. You know, it's funny, this really got on our radar screen last year, last spring, when we had an individual contact us through the Florida State Golf Association. He was a golfer who happened to be blind, and he was wanting to qualify for the U.S. Open. And actually, later that summer, he came back and said, I want to qualify for the U.S. Amateur. Will the Florida State Golf Association adopt the modified rules for golfers with disabilities for U.S. Open qualifying? And so we discussed that, and they are a set of rules that need to be adopted by the committee in charge of the competition. We talked about it, and we made it very clear, both internally and externally, that we were going to be inclusive. And yes, by all means, the Florida State Golf Association and any other entity should adopt those rules to be inclusive of those individuals. And if he would have qualified for the U.S. Open, we'd have adopted them at the U.S. Open or the U.S. Amateur as well. And that's what's coming. Embracing this community, we think, is critically important. And I think also from an innovation standpoint, educating the industry about what this can mean for the game, for the business of golf, for embracing this community. And we think it's great for all of the above. But there is going to take some education. What are the agronomic considerations on a golf course with wheelchairs and canes and crutches? There are some misperceptions, and I think the USGA and all of us together in North America can play a role in clarifying some of those. It's not the only thing that we're innovating as it pertains to governance. If you can go to the next slide. Imagine a world handicap system. To governance, when we say governance at the USGA and with our partners at the RNA, we talk about the playing rules, the rules of amateur status, the equipment rules, and the rules of handicapping. And we are in the process of herding the cats with this one. This is a world handicap system that the USGA and the RNA are leading, but five other handicap authorities around the world, among other countries. We began discussions with the RNA to begin leading this and resourcing it in 2012. It is about to come to fruition. We're not at the end of that journey, but we're very close. And simply our objectives are to create one algorithm, one handicap system worldwide. So whether you're playing in LA or London or Boston or Beijing or Tokyo or Toronto, you're playing under handicap that was computed the same way, under the same course ratings, and playing equitably with anybody, anywhere, at any time. And we think that's a noble thing. It's not different than what we, unlike what we did with the rules of golf, partnering with the RNA in 1952 for one set of rules, or in 2012 with one set of rules of amateur status, and we're excited about it. And so just finally, a couple of pieces. The next slide, please. There's a world handicap research team that crunches all the numbers with developing this algorithm, looking at course rating. It is a worldwide body of folks from around the globe that are a lot smarter than me, and statisticians and mathematicians. And one of the innovations they've come up with, the system, a world handicap system, will be based on the USGA handicap system predominantly, an average-based system where most all scores are posted, what we use throughout North America. But other parts of the world, it's much different. It's an incremental system that are based largely on competition scores. But we're combining, taking as a basis, the USGA course and slope rating system. Slope is used around most of the world. And we're going to take the best of all the other systems to come up with a world handicap system. This is one example. A daily playing adjustment. We don't have that here in North America, but what it is if you're out at your golf course, just down the road here at Shaughnessy Golf and Country Club in Vancouver, they don't get a lot of wind, but if there's a 40-mile-an-hour windy day or some other weather condition, or they've just had the Canadian Open and the rough is at 6 or 8 inches, those differences will affect the course rating. And now, as golfers play that day and they shoot higher scores than they normally would, this system will now make an automatic adjustment at the end of the day to reflect that, and golfers' handicaps for that day will be adjusted. It'll automatically happen within the system. Technology will allow us to do that. And imagine with 50 million scores posted on GIN this year, just in the United States, if we combine 16 million golfers, help grow that number, and then capture and use that data from those golfers, what power, what benefit that could be for our game on a lot of fronts. So all of that technology, all of that cooperation, collaboration, the herding of cats, we're almost at the end of that journey, and this is one innovation among many. So we're excited about it. We think it's good for the game and look forward to more cooperation.
Look at you guys, right on time. You must be in the governance and the looking at rules and things and everything. You're just right down to the last second. We will transition now. I'll ask Roland and Federico to leave the stage. And if we do that, we can give them a round of applause. That'd be great for their efforts here today. And I'm going to hand this over to you.
Okay.
And call up Thomas Pagel, because our next session, here he is all about the rules modernization. And I think this is going to be the one where the questions start to make this iPad smoke a little bit. We'll see. Good luck, guys.
Thank you.
Thomas, you didn't get your walk-up music that
I know.
You wanted?
I requested John Denver. Just didn't
That
happen.
Was the problem, yes. Well, my goodness, by now I think everybody's at least somewhat familiar with our little announcement of last week on March 1. The USJ and the RNA announced a project, some outcomes from a project we've been working on for the last 5 years, entitled Our Rules Modernization, Modernizing the Rules of Golf. And today, Thomas and I would like to just give you a quick overview and speak to a few of the changes about that project and how we plan to deliver the new rules, and then just open it up for a discussion, some questions. So think about your questions. We'd love to engage with you. Most of you in this room probably know that the rules are revised on a 4-year cycle every 4 years. And you know, we just felt a few years ago in informal discussions between the USGA and the RNA, of which Thomas was involved from day one, that the rules were complicated, were nuanced, could be more simple to use, easier to use and understand and apply by golfers all around the world. And so from those early discussions in the spring of 2012, this project came about. And when you think of the way the game has advanced, like I mentioned before, with technology and globalization, we heard a word bunkerization yesterday and gamification yesterday, and you think about how putting greens and rough are maintained these days. We really wanted to update the rules for today's changing global game, and make no mistake about it, it is global. And this is disruptive. This is innovation, we think, from everything from the language or the changes themselves, the content, to the language that we will write the rules in and how the rules are delivered. And we'll share a little bit about that with you as we go along. Next slide. Really, just a couple of things. This was a comprehensive review process to modernize. As I said, the USGA began this initiative 5 years ago. It was a great cooperative venture between our two organizations. It included our rules departments, committees, other experts, including representatives from the tours and other amateur associations. It was really a collaborative process, and we're proud of that. The process included, we didn't do a whole bunch of historical research. We didn't just start from the present state, and we didn't just say, well, here's how we ought to change the rules to make them better. We looked back at every single rule and its history, how it evolved and what it was today, and then thought about how we might reimagine that going forward. I'm old enough to remember the day when we used to drop it over our shoulder. Some of you probably are in this room too. It used to be years ago that not only would you drop it over the ball over your shoulder, but you would have to throw it over your shoulder because it had to go at least 6 yards before it was in play. Those are some of the things that we found as we looked at the history of the rules. And what we thought had existed as a rule forever really had gone through a lot of evolution and often changed. And what we thought was a new idea in some instances, like leaving the flag stick in the hole, was actually something that we did as late as the 1960s. And so really, it just revealed to us there aren't a whole lot of new ideas. But let's hear from golfers and what they informed us of what they thought of the rules. Let's play the video.
Absolutely love the game, and the rules are very complicated.
The rules have just remained in the past.
Yes, I think some of the rules are a little unfair. I did see a book that I'd have to read before I start playing, so I would say they're pretty difficult.
When I want to find something out about the rules, I just want to get to it quickly.
Yeah, if I could do one thing in the game, it would be for me to make the rules easier for everybody to understand.
It's not so much as changing the rules as doing a better job of explaining the rules.
Please make them easier and more understandable for everyone.
Well, we listened, And I think that's an important message through this. It was for us. And so just a few of the overall goals, and I'll turn it over to Thomas to talk about some of the changes. But as I said, we wanted to bring the rules up to date to meet changing global game. And golf is played in more parts around the world than it ever has been. In fact, even as 10, 15 years ago, golf is growing in parts of Eastern Europe and other parts of the world that there are things that are just different in how the game is played around the world. Really, our overall all goals with these modernized rules were to make them more easily understood and applied by all golfers, wherever they were in the world, to be more consistent, simple, and fair. And we think if we can achieve those three words, it will make our game more approachable for all golfers. We wanted to reinforce the game's longstanding principles and character. And what I mean by that is it's kind of covered by two of our guiding themes. While we wanted to consider far-reaching rule changes, as I said, we looked at every single rule, but we did not want to change the fundamental character and principles that the game has enjoyed for centuries, such as play the ball as it lies and play the course as you find it. We wanted to still be playing golf at the end of this initiative. Secondly, we wanted to make these revisions with all golfers in mind, not just elite professionals and amateurs, but everyone, beginners, high handicappers, and club and recreational golfers from around the world. And we hope we've achieved that, but we're listening. We're listening some more, and we'll talk about that. But before we do, I'd like to turn it over to Thomas to share a few of the changes and some thoughts behind them.
Thank you, John. So my question is, do you remember the day of having to toss it over your shoulder? Were you, not yet, but I think that was what?
Nice try.
Late 1800s?
That's going to cost you.
Yeah, shouldn't say that to my boss. I apologize. So again, by now, we're about a week into the preview period, and I'll talk a little bit about the history, but it was 5 years in the making, and obviously March 1st was circled on our calendar because we were just so excited to share it with the world, but these 2 days have also been circled on our calendar because it's just so great to get in a room with industry leaders and friends and be able to talk about the rules and what we're proposing for 2019. And John did give me a time limit for my section, but as many of you know, I can just talk on and on and on. So John, I'll do my best here. So as John mentioned, we looked at everything. You think of the rules of golf as a puzzle, right? We pulled those puzzle pieces apart. We looked at every single corner, every outcome, the language, how is it written? What were the penalties that were applied in certain situations? And over the course of the 5 years, as we looked at those and understood the history, then we got to the point of putting it back together, and that's where we are today. So we're previewing a set of proposals with that puzzle that's been put back together, very much a package. So some samples here. Again, if you go to our website or go to the RNA website, there's hundreds of changes, but 30 or so that we've called major changes, and we're gonna talk about a few of those here today. So first, relaxed putting green rules. So I think everybody had heard the local rule that was put into place that we announced in December for no longer penalizing a player for accidental movement of a ball on a putting green. That's going to be part of the proposed changes for 2019, but we're actually going to go one step further in those situations. And in those situations, once you've marked and lifted your golf ball on the putting green, when you put it back, if it moves for any reason, no penalty, and you're just going to always put the ball back where it was lifted from. And it seems like a minor change, but even under today's rules, if you think of the local rule, we still have to ask the player the question. Did you move the ball, or did something else move the ball? Because that's going to dictate where you play from. As we analyzed those scenarios, we said, you know what? Your ball earned that spot. You earned that spot with your last stroke. Just always put it back. We don't need to figure out if we're going to play it from where it came to rest after the wind blew it, or you move it back. If you were the cause of the movement, just always play from that spot that you had earned. And I don't know how many people saw Billy Horschel last year, the 15th hole at Augusta. It's a little windy. Marks lifts his golf ball. He's on the front right-hand side of the green, replaces the ball, goes to walk around to read his line of putt, and Augusta wind blows, comes up and blows his ball into the water hazard. Let's just say I was happy that I was watching it on TV, and I was not stationed on 15 that day. It was my good friend David Rickman, who had to go have a conversation with Billy and say, you know what, that's actually a one-stroke penalty, and now you need to apply the water hazard rule. When I ran into Billy at Torrey Pines this year, I told him this was one of the changes, and he just laughed and said, thank you, it's about time. So one change on the putting green, a couple other changes. Flag stick, no longer a penalty if you strike an unattended flag stick that's left in the hole. And you think about this from a pace of play perspective. You know, if John and I are playing, he hits a greenside bunker shot, he's down there tidying up. As I've been saying, as golfers, we're all optimists, right? I've got that 40-foot putt. I think it's going in the hole. So what am I doing today? I'm walking forward 40 feet to pull the flag stick out. I'm probably going to miss it by 5, but in case I made it, I wanted to pull it. In the future, you know what? Just go ahead and step up and putt. And if you happen to hit the flag stick, there's no reason to penalize you there. So another proposal. Last one that I'll talk about on the putting green, repair of damage. You know, you look at putting greens today and putting surfaces, and they are so good. And the thought process is, once your ball's on the putting green, what do we want to do as golfers? We want to keep it on the ground. Let's let skill dictate whether or not that ball gets in the hole, not some damage that happens to be on your line of putt. You got a 5-foot putt, there's a little shoe print on your line of putt, go ahead and fix it. Now, a lot of people with respect to this over the last week, and of course, as we socialize this with players and industry partners, a lot of folks said, well, pace of play. Guys are going to take forever now. You know what? There's a rule for that. Let's enforce the pace of play policies and the pace of play rules rather than throwing the baby out with the bathwater here. So allow the player to repair damage. A lot of people have also said, well, guys are just going to build a trough to the hole now. They're just going to take their putter and walk all 40 feet and build a line. We've got a rule for that too, right? We say you can't improve your line of play. What this is going to allow for you to do is to take reasonable actions to ensure that you have the same putting surface as the group in front of you. You know, it's funny, under today's rules, we say you can't repair that damage, but the etiquette would suggest that you repair it when you're done with the hole, so the group behind you is okay. And it's like, well, why is that? Why not give you the benefit of the doubt as well? This next category, relaxed rules for penalty areas. Now, some of you course operators may have already been doing this, and we recognize that, and that was frankly one of the reflections as we looked at golf courses throughout the world. Why not allow for course operators to mark areas that are not just water hazards? So as course operators, you know where players are hitting it, you know where players are losing balls, you know where players are spending 5 minutes to search for their golf ball. Go ahead and put a red line down. Could be a hillside, could be a desert, could be a forest. We're in Panama. You know, we had areas of jungle that I know that they would like to mark. So again, player goes in there, player can't find it, let him drop out with a 1-stroke penalty. You know, if a player can find it, that's great. They're still going to be able to play it, but this helps in those situations so that they don't have to go back and play again under stroke and distance. A big one, pace of play support. You know, as we looked at the objectives for the overall project, one of those is how can the playing rules support other industry objectives, one of those being pace of play. So you look at a few things that are being done. For the first time ever, the rules are actually going to state a time that you are expected to play. It's a recommended time because we recognize that each situation can be a little different, but the rules will actually state that as a player, when it's your turn to play, you can play without distractions, it's safe, you should be able to pull the trigger within 40 seconds. That's now going to be in the rules, first time ever. We're also going to introduce a new form of play. Show of hands, who out there plays Stableford? You know, it's interesting. If we were in Australia and asked that question, 100% would raise their hand. But culturally speaking, and I heard somebody reference this in one of the talks yesterday, you know, we all like to know what our score is. We like strokes. We like scores. So Stableford hasn't really picked up in North America. This new form of play called maximum score will allow for a committee to set a maximum score per hole. So the committee can say, you know what, under today's event, we're going to play maximum score, and it's going to be net double bogey. When you get a net double bogey, scorecard's not going to show anything worse. Go ahead and pick that ball up and keep moving. No need to hole out for your 14. I think that was the example that was given yesterday. So go ahead and pick up and move on. Very important. You look at some of the other changes, and again, in their aggregate, they could have a positive benefit on pace of play as well. Little things, taking time of ball search from 5 minutes to 3 minutes. You know, with that, eliminating the penalty for moving your own ball during search, right? When you're searching for your ball, the rules should help you, the player, find your ball. So now we've eliminated the penalty. We're going to take it down to 3 minutes, but we're going to encourage you to search. We're also going to encourage you to play provisional balls. So you start looking at all these things that come together. We talked about penalty areas. Again, minimizing the amount of times that players have to go backwards. Put in a penalty area if you know players are often losing balls there. Help speed things up. The flag stick, again, several examples. We could go on and on and on where in their aggregate we think will help support positive pace of play. And then, you know, elimination of many penalties. As we pulled that puzzle apart, as I mentioned, we didn't just look at rule outcomes. We looked at a lot of penalties. Is it appropriate to apply a penalty here? Is the right penalty being applied? You think about loose impediments, right? Loose impediments in bunkers and in the future in penalty areas. Is the challenge to navigate that little stick that's right behind your ball as you take your backswing, you know, Brian Davis? Or is it to actually play this challenging shot out of this less than ideal terrain? So removing the penalty, now allowing players to move loose impediments. Same thing in penalty areas, allowing for players to ground their club or take practice swings, no longer a penalty. You know, one of the misconceptions that's come out over the last week is people assume that that's going to apply in bunkers as well, and that's not the case. In bunkers, you're still not going to be able to touch the ground anywhere near your ball. You're still not going to be able to test the condition. That's really a practical reason for the superintendents out there. I'm sure you don't want bunker sand deposited all over your greens, so that has not changed, I can assure you that. But again, as we look through, what are the appropriate penalties? If you strike yourself with your golf ball, should you be penalized? Is that going to be a good outcome? Likely not, right? So no penalty. There's no reason to apply a penalty there. Ball moved. We talked about balls being moved on the putting green. No longer a penalty. What about in all other scenarios? You know, what is the determination, or how do we determine whether or not you caused your ball to move? Let's look at knowledge or virtual certainty. So again, in the future, under the proposed rules, you're only penalized for moving your ball if we know you moved your ball. If there's any question, we're going to give you the benefit of the doubt. So no longer these 51, 49. I think many of you have probably heard me state those percentages a time or two. That goes away as part of the proposals. And another factor with the penalties has to do with relying on greater player integrity. Relying on a player's reasonable judgment when they're taking relief or when they're putting a ball into play. What I mean by that is think of a scenario where a player marks and lifts their golf ball on the putting green. They go to put it back. How often do you get your ball back on the exact spot? Probably not very often at all. You're really, really close. But you're not always going to get it on the right spot. So let's say some zoomed-in television footage shows that the player's ball is an eighth of an inch off because somebody triangulated at home against a blemish that they saw on the putting green. Did the player gain any advantage? No. Was the player doing what was reasonable? Yes. There's no reason for the rules then to interject themselves and second-guess that player's action. Same thing in determining your nearest point of relief. It's an imprecise act. You're going to get really close, but I'm sure it could be challenged where, you know what, you could have actually been an inch closer to that cart path. But you know what, if you did what was reasonable, there's no reason for the rules to second guess. So just some examples of how, under the proposed rules, we're looking to eliminate some penalties. Next slide, please. Now, milestones with this initiative. As John mentioned, 2012 is when we started this. It was April in 2012. We came together with our partners in governance at the RNA and just on reflection and through observation said, you know, with our four-year processes, we've dealt with discrete issues. As we looked at particular outcomes, as we've tried to be more fair, the rules have become more subjective. For many, they've become too complicated. For many, the language is too dense. So let's fix that. And so that's where we started in trying to set out to make the rules easier to understand, easier to apply, looking at delivery. How can we write the rules so that they're easier for all golfers to learn and understand? And then, as I mentioned last week, on March 1st, we started this preview period. John will hit on our feedback period that we're currently in that'll take us through August 31st of this year. And then when that feedback period is concluded, we're going to go back and we'll finish drafting. And then in the springtime of 2018, we'll come out and we'll present the final code to the golf community. Again, following the feedback period and following the conclusion of the drafting. And the rules will take effect on January 1st, 2019. And one of the questions we get is why so long? You know, it's been a positive reaction over the last week. Why not just do these now? And there's two reasons. First, I'll tell you, this period of feedback, we're genuine in that we want to hear from golfers. We want to hear from all golfers. Again, John will hit on that. And that takes time. The drafting process itself takes time. And then once we're done drafting, think about all the education. Think about the creation of publications, the creation of digital apps. All those things just take time. And so January 1st, 2019, we think is the appropriate target, and that's what we're committed to. Now, from an education perspective, again, you think of 100-plus changes, you think of 30 major changes, there's going to be a lot for people to learn, just the breadth and scope of what's been done as part of this initiative. And I'm not just talking referees. I'm talking all golfers. And so as we look towards 2019, we're rethinking how we educate. We're going to focus on the digital space. We don't want to just educate in a classroom environment. How can we use gamification? One of my favorite terms when it comes to education. How can we use gamification from a rules perspective to help encourage and engage with golfers so they can learn in advance of 2019? You know, our workshop program that we put on with the PGA of America in the United States, typically we start on January 1st, even in a rule change year. That's all going to change. You're going to see us going out with those workshop programs in the middle of 2018, because we recognize that a lot of those attendees then need to go out and educate golfers at their clubs or in their golf community. You know, and with that, educating at the grassroots level is also critically important, and we recognize that. So we're going to be coming out with some turnkey products that we can pass along to clubs, pass along to the state and regional golf associations, so that they can then go out and educate their members on these rules in advance of 2019. Again, so it's a massive effort. It's one that we're committed to. We understand how critically important it is, and you're going to hear more from us on that here in the near future.
Well, and Thomas has spoken about just a little piece of some of this change. You've probably heard about a great deal of it over the last week. The rules will now include, we're even contemplating photos and graphs and images right in the rule book. We've got something we're calling the Players Edition, which will have the comprehensive rules, and we'll have the Players Edition, which we think most players will carry in their golf bag. We're writing those rules in common everyday language like we'll use today and people use on the golf course and when they play. We're thinking about technology and how quickly it's advancing. And when 2019 comes, how can we embrace that? How can we embrace mobile devices? Because that's where people are going to go. And instead of looking in the book about how to take a drop off of a cart path, you just punch a button and look at a video, a 10, 15 second video clip about how to do it, and visually you see that. So we're considering all of that, and we want to hear from all of you and golfers around the world on every bit of that. Changes, how we deliver, how we're presenting it, how we're proposing to present it. So as Thomas mentioned, March 1 commenced our feedback period. For the next 6 months through the end of the summer, the end of August, golfers can submit feedback through these avenues to both the RNA and the USGA, either by going to our respective websites. And really, as Thomas also mentioned earlier, there is a wide variety of explanatory materials there and tools that really will help golfers of every level and ability to understand and comprehend these changes. We'd encourage you to go there. But there's also a survey that will allow golfers to really tell us what they think about these new rules. Email, social posts, even giving us a call at the office. We want to engage with golfers. We want to listen to golfers. We've already had thousands engage with us, and we want to really hear from everyone. We've already benefited from that. I can tell you there are examples of things that we've heard already that will benefit the process, just with some of the language that we've used in the new code and the new rules. And that's all been beneficial. But really, what this is all about, it's really pretty informal. We just want golfers to go and try these rules. Take them out to the golf course and just give them a try. Dropping from just above the ground, or the relief area, or any of the other changes that Thomas has mentioned, and the more than 30 major changes. And then just tell us what they think. We have a sample rule sheet on our website, as does the RNA. And you can print that, you can take it out and play with your foursome, or you can take it to your facility and have a day where you try these new rules and let all of your golfers try these new rules, and then let us know what you think and encourage them to let us know what you think. I should mention, if you do that, and if you play around under these new rules, remember, we only have one set of rules at a time, and we're currently still playing under the rules that were approved on January 1, 2016. So if you do play under the new rules, those scores are not permitted to be posted for handicap purposes. So just know that. But we do want to hear from you, and we're excited about that. It is innovative for us in a lot of ways, but we think it'll be greatly beneficial to the process. So with that, I think we'll either give a whole bunch of time back, Bob, or we'll answer some questions.
How's that iPad doing?
I'd like to go through all these questions, but I have a 5:30 flight. I thought I'd start with this question. Where is it here? Sorry. It comes from someone, they keep coming in so quick, I can't get to the Just hold your horses, folks. I thought I'd start with this one. It comes from somebody named Diana Murphy. Have you heard of her? You know her? She wanted to know why 20 inches versus club length, and what about stroke and distance?
Okay, so I will tackle those, John. So again, if you think of the rules, I'll speak to the 20 inches and 80 inches versus club lengths. If you think of the rules, again, as that package, the revised dropping procedure that John mentioned, we're now getting away from the prescriptive shoulder height. We're saying, you know, your objective as a player is just to get the ball on the ground by dropping it, and we're not going to focus on the mechanism of how you do that. You can drop it from any height. So you can be an inch above the grass. We still get that desired level of randomness because that ball is going to sit down in the rough versus placing it. But we also eliminate all the complexities that come with what happens when your ball hits the ground and rolls one of nine places and you have to redrop it. So that was the motivation behind the change dropping procedure. And we said, you know, as we do that, can we now make the relief area smaller? Can we keep the player closer to the condition that they're actually taking relief from? So, for example, you're taking relief from a cart path. Can we make it so that everybody's going to be within the same standard area closer to that cart path as opposed to John dropping, or excuse me, using his 47-inch driver to measure his one area, and I'm using my wedge at 39 inches. There's a consistency there. And then the 80 inches when you're taking penalty relief. I will note, however, the 20 inches, we're also going to use that in some other places as well. So it's not just those areas of free relief. You're taking relief from a penalty area, and you go back on a line, which you'll still be able to do, just like the current water hazard rules. Instead of prescribing, you have to be right on that line, you're actually going to get the benefit of 20 inches on either side of that line. You go back and you do play under stroke and distance. Rather than having to drop right at the spot or as near as possible where you last played from, you're going to have 20 inches from there. So it's no longer this debate, am I dropping in the divot? Am I dropping right behind the divot? You know, find your reference point, you're going to get 20 inches no closer to the hole on either side. So again, it was that particular change was all about adding some consistency into the rules. Now, segue to stroke and distance. This is a topic that, frankly, somebody asked, you know, what was the longest conversation that you had when you started this 5 years ago? And I said, well, it has to be stroke and distance because we're still talking. We are committed to continuing the conversation. We'd love to find a solution to keep players from having to go backwards, but there's some challenges there. If you go to our website or the RNA's website, there's actually a paper that we've published with the resources that outlines all the various alternatives that we tried throughout this process to, again, look to identify a solution for stroke and distance, and we just haven't found one that's workable in all situations. People will say, well, just, you know, take relief from a boundary, just like you do taking lateral relief from a penalty area. Well, there are some challenges there. I was speaking with a golf course architect earlier, and, you know, think about strategy perspective. You think about safety. You have homes lining the golf course. So there's some real concerns there. So there's alternatives that we've tried. We're still looking. We're committed to continuing the conversation. We want people to take a look at the alternatives that we've tried, give us their feedback there, and if they've thought of something else, we want to hear that too.
Okay. That's a good one. This is a little more general, but I think it's smart. What change do you think will have the biggest impact on the game?
I'll comment on that. I don't know that, you know, I've thought about that and I've had that question. I don't think there's one. I think everybody will have their own sort of change that they gravitate to, or maybe a couple of them. But to me, I think the biggest change that all of these changes kind of add up to is the elimination of a lot of penalties. You know, we talked about that a lot, you know, being able to move loose impediments in a penalty area or in a bunker. You know, or you just think about that. Well, you know, we've had some comment about that. But think about the times when a golfer is in one of those areas and just nicks a leaf or barely touches the water. Thomas at Augusta last year at the Masters, he sits in the TV, watching the broadcast.
It's a bad gig.
It's a thankless job. But Zach Johnson, some of you may remember, at Rays Creek, he barely clipped the water with his wedge playing a ball in that water hazard. He didn't even know it. He had no idea. And they saw it on television. It was clear. They came in, and he had no advantage. You know, you clip that loose impediment, you clip that water, there's no advantage. Why should there be a penalty? So we've relaxed the rules in that regard, and I think, as Thomas mentioned, ball search. We want you to search for the ball. We have this odd dynamic now where you could have a whole gallery of 1,000 people searching for your ball while you stand on the sidelines and watch because you don't want that penalty. Deflected balls moving on the accidentally moving on the putting green, all kinds of things. I think there are so much change and elimination from a common sense perspective of penalty. It will be good for the game. It will make the game more approachable. Mm-hmm. Well, and I should comment on that too. I don't think we see this as a grow the game initiative. We do not. As I said, consistent, simple, and fair will make our game more approachable. Making the rules easier to understand and apply for golfers all around the world will make our game more approachable. But it's not, we didn't do this to bring a gazillion new people to the game. Is it a piece of the puzzle that could help with that? Absolutely. Embracing pace of play and embracing environmental stewardship, player integrity, all of those things we thought about as themes throughout the rules, when we looked, as Thomas said, pulled apart the puzzle and put it back together, we thought of all those things. We thought about translation. Many new golfers in places like China and Azerbaijan and Poland, and where the game is growing, what does rub of the green transfer to? Or through the green? What, you talk about confusing terms. It's confusing here in the English-speaking and Spanish-speaking world, let alone in Mandarin or in Arabic. And so we were very careful to think about using everyday language and how that might translate in updating the rules for a modern global game.
The one question that's come in a number of times here, of course, is about the divot. Why don't you handle that one?
The divot. I will address the divot. You know, obviously, as you look throughout comment boards, and this was pre-announcement, but it's certainly something we've heard since the announcement as well, is golfers always say, I hit a really good shot in the fairway and I'm in a divot. Will the proposed rule changes fix it? And the answer is no. You remember back to John's slide where he said maintaining the core principles of the game. Principle number one is you play your balls at lies. There are exceptions to that when you're playing, but you're either paying a penalty stroke or you're able to do something else with your golf ball because there's something in your way that shouldn't be there, some man-made object. And so, one of the challenges, and my personal opinion, one of the things that makes the game so much fun is you hit it, you find it, you analyze and assess where your ball came to rest, and you hit it again. You take the good with the bad. As I was talking to some players in advance of the announcement, no one complains about that great lie they get in the rough after they hit a bad shot, but yet they start talking about divots and fairways. So again, it's just that principle is so fundamental to the game, and we felt like we'd be compromising that principle by allowing a player to take free relief because their ball happens to come to rest in a divot. And not to sound like a philosopher, but I also always say, when is a divot no longer a divot? If it starts to sprig up just a little bit of grass, is that a divot? Am I gonna get relief, am I not? If I'm in a competitive match at my club, am I now gonna stop and ask for a ruling? If I'm playing at the professional level, am I now going to call in a referee and have a point of contention or subjectivity? So that one little change that sounds so simple, not only is it compromised a principle, but it also could create some challenging and complicated scenarios, and it's just best to avoid all of that.
This is an interesting one here. How specifically do you think the modernized rules might change the way recreational golfers relate to the rules, and more importantly, how they feel about the ruling bodies?
I'll jump into that one. I think, as I said, we considered these changes with all golfers in mind, not just elite professionals or amateurs. Everybody, beginners, high handicappers, club players, and so on. We're hopeful. That's what the feedback period is about. See how golfers do relate to these new rules, what they think about them. But some examples of how we think the recreational game would embrace these proposed new rules. Maximum score, Thomas referred to. Think about that now. A committee can set a maximum score for a hole in a competition. A player can exceed that, pick up, and go on and still have a score for the hole and be in that competition. It helps with pace of play. It keeps them in the competition. Move on. How about bunkers? How many of you have ever had a tough time getting out of a bunker? And some of the bunkers that are built today that some of our friends in the golf course architect business have built have been amazingly fun, but sometimes difficult to get out of for some players who are new to the game. And so we now have, the rules will now allow, if your ball is up against the lip of a bunker and you don't think you can get it out, and you want to take an unplayable lie, you can come out of the bunker under penalty of two strokes along a line, and you can get out that way under penalty of two strokes. Penalty fits the crime. So, but you still have to negotiate that bunker. We think that will be beneficial for many in the recreational game. There are other changes that we thought about. I don't know, help me if you think of another example, Thomas, but that's part of the feedback period too. We want to hear maybe ideas that we didn't cover. We feel good where we are, where we're aligned, but we know we'll get some good ideas.
Okay. One that came up here too was talking about someone perhaps putting with the stick, the flag still in the cup, and using that perhaps as a backstop on a downhill slippery putt.
Yeah, I think that what we're going to see is it's going to end up being a level of personal preference, and we're okay with that. I mean, think about players that play from just off the putting green today. You see some players that want to leave the flag stick in, others that want to take it out. We think you'll see that carried through for players that are playing from the putting green as well. And it's, you know, there's been some research, and I think it's been inconclusive to show whether or not it's a benefit. So, again, golfers are creative, and I think personal preference will win the day there.
Okay. This is sort of what you dealt with, but if a course has an area traditionally marked as out of bounds, what would prevent them from simply remarking this area as a penalty area and completely eliminating out of bounds? Do you think courses will do that?
So as we look to go final with these, we're going to be offering some very prescriptive guidance to committees. I would say that the rules aren't going to prohibit a committee from doing that, but again, we want them to think long and hard before they do. I mentioned two of the challenges, one being from a strategic standpoint. Again, if you have players taking on out of bounds where they hadn't in the past, that's going to change the integrity of a golf hole. Do you want that? The other is, frankly, the safety concern. You know, having grown up in Denver, I'm used to a lot of golf courses that are in a community, right? You have houses everywhere. Guess what? You mark it as a penalty area. What's that backyard now? It's no longer out of bounds. So if I find him, am I going to go play? Am I going to get relief from the trampoline? Like, what's, you know, what if a kid's playing in the backyard? I mean, there's just some real issues that you need to thoughtfully think through as a committee. But again, with respect to boundaries and stroke and distance, as I said before, I mean, we're committed to identifying or continuing to discuss and try and identify a solution. And so we'd be hopeful that we could find something there to perhaps minimize the number of times that a committee were to take that action.
Here's one that I haven't heard anything about, and it's interesting. What about the rule that may have cost Mark Rowe the Open on the scorecard swap? That ever come up?
So scorecards have been a continued conversation since really the 80s, and you look, we have a lot of history there. So now from a scorecard perspective, again, if your name's on the scorecard, that's your scorecard, and that's still going to be a critical component. You get a wrong score on a hole, if you just do bad math, still going to be a penalty of disqualification. However, you know, the recent change where we're going to open it back up if you fail to include a penalty, that will be maintained as part of the proposals as well. So the reliance on a scorecard is still there. It's still your warranty to the field and stroke play. We haven't changed that. What we have done and what the proposed rules will do is allow for electronic scorecards. You're still going to have the requirement to attest at the end, so you're going to need some signature, whether it's electronic or you scribble it down on a piece of paper, but allowing for players to maintain their scores electronically and then input that into a system, again, with the attestation. So we think that's an exciting change, but given the nature of stroke play and you have numerous players in the field, we just think it's critically important to maintain that.
Got a couple here that are, I'm going to sort of combine, but basically any thoughts about equipment-related rules that came into this? Did anything about equipment come into the new rules?
I would say this is about the playing rules. This modernization was about the playing rules. The equipment rules were not part of this review. That's a separate sort of thing. But you know, I would say that you know, call out distance measuring devices. We did reverse what the current rules say, and that now it is a rule of golf that you are permitted to use a distance measuring device when you play. That was a misnomer for a lot of folks, and that they just thought that already was a rule of golf when it had to be, it was a local rule that had to be adopted by the committee, and so it was a penalty trap. If the committee didn't adopt it, it was a severe penalty for golfers that happened to use one and found out later. So we just thought it made sense, common sense, just make it a rule of golf, and if you want to prohibit them, then you adopt the local rule to do it, and it eliminates that penalty that penalty trap. And I would say too, another theme that we thought about a lot, Thomas gave the example of electronic scorecards. DMDs is another one. We did consider technology and how it's advancing, not certainly in how we deliver the rules and educate for the rules, the digital world and all that we'll do, but also where the world's going from a technology standpoint. Equipment's a big part of that, but also are the playing rules, and we'll continue to look at that. We thought about where the current state is in 2017, and we know one thing for sure, it's gonna be different in 2019, and it's something we'll continue to look at.
Now, with respect, I'll just jump in. So the playing rules, outside of the specifications, we still do have rules on clubs and balls, and one change in particular has to deal with clubs that are damaged. Currently, if a player damages a club in anger, so a player just gets a little upset and doesn't do the Woody Austin over the head, but just does a little tap on the foot and gets a small dent in their putter, if they make a stroke, one more stroke, they're disqualified. Under the proposals, that all goes away. And we say, if you damage a club, irregardless of how you damage it, you can continue to use it. So the days of putting with a 3-wood or a sand wedge likely are gone. But with that, as the player, you're going to start with up to 14 clubs. If you start with less than 14, you can still add during your round. But those are your weapons, so to speak, for that day. So if you damage your club during a round, and let's say your driver face cracks or completely breaks, you're no longer going to be able to replace that. So you have your 14 clubs. That's what you've selected for play. But again, you can continue to use a club regardless of how it's damaged.
And I would just add to that by saying it's just for that round. And it's not, and just to clarify, just to add on to what Thomas just said, it's not just when you do it in anger. It's if you are chipping out from a tree and you tweak your shaft. It's for any reason that you can continue to use that damaged club for that round. So we think that's a good change.
How are you going to measure the success of the rules changes? Or lack thereof?
I'll go first, John, and you can jump in. For me, I'm gonna measure success through engagement. I mean, it's not just comprehension, but it's also engagement with the rules. You talk about just thinking about things differently. We recognize that golfers engage with information just like everyone else differently now. Technology, as John was mentioning, we're gonna have the ability to have so many more touch points with our fellow golfers. And I think an increase in those touch points outside of a written book is a positive. And so again, comprehension is obviously a measure we'll always look at. Do golfers understand the rules of golf, but also are they engaging with the rules of golf? Are we breaking down a little bit of that intimidation barrier to make the game more approachable, to make the rules a bit more intuitive?
I would add to that too. I think it's an important point, and Thomas is exactly right. But I think it's important to point out that this is a different process for us. To engage, we wanted this engagement to be a discussion, to truly engage with golfers. Instead of just decreeing from on high and handing down these rules, which sometimes in the past we've done, we wanted to open this engagement. We wanted to let golfers comment. We wanted all of you to be a part of this. And I think that's important. We will look at how we educate for this too, as Thomas spoke to. We've done a good job at the USGA and the RNA of educating the elite referees for the opens and for state amateurs and so on. Where I think there's a great opportunity is for us to educate the grassroots, as Thomas alluded to. And we need to do that in bite-sized chunks. Most golfers aren't gonna sit through a 3-day, let alone a 1-day rules workshop. And not many people do that. But they will take bite-sized chunks. A golf professional at a club has a 2-minute video that our team and the RNA are creating and a 2-paragraph script to talk about relief areas or penalty hazards and do that on a Thursday night when they have a wine and cheese tasting after a couple's golf outing, 9-hole couple's golf outing, and take 10 minutes to do that 6 times through the summer. That's how we think we're gonna teach and train the trainers and do it with high school kids and partner with the college coaches and PGA professionals and USGA and Golf Canada committee people. It's gonna be a broad effort. We can't do it all from Golf House or from St. Andrews. We need everybody's help, and we look forward to that engagement as well.
I think you're probably counting on a lot of people in this room to kind of drive that engagement a little bit,
aren't
you? Gentlemen, thank you very much. I can't wait for the date when we have a rules seminar followed by speed dating on golf courses.
Give them something to talk about.
We've learned everything on this golf this family. Thank you. Thanks. Perfect. Thank you. All right. We have one more panel before our break, and this is a very interesting one, and I'd like to call upon Steve Schloss to come on up. This is a panel discussion on driving innovation through inclusion, and I think this is a brilliant one. Here joining Steve is Michelle Collins, Jolly Dhaliwal, Chris Johansson, and Helen Young. Come on up, everybody. I think I got everybody. Oh, Patrick Kelly, of course. Excuse me. How could I forget Patrick?
There are five. So. No, we got five. There's five of them, but it's okay. No problem. Good morning, everybody. This was not exactly the way we were going to set it up, but welcome. Thank you. Thank you for being here. So what I wanted to do was start by first reflecting on the conversation that we had last night with Jerry Yang. And Jerry talked about the opportunities that exist in Silicon Valley. And the one thing that he talked about very specifically was the notion of creating opportunities where people of different backgrounds and capabilities get together. And through that opportunity comes great outcomes, innovation, new products, things that might in fact change the world. And in some ways, that connects to the event yesterday and today. How are we taking people of different backgrounds and capabilities, and through that, creating new opportunities to innovate? And so in many ways, this group here, members of the board for British Columbia Golf, are another manifestation of that idea. So if there's one thing that you would come away with from this session this morning and yesterday and with this group here, is the notion of leveraging difference to make a difference. This is one of the areas that we believe is a very important outcome for the game. Inside the USGA, we feel strongly about difference as a key differentiator, and we believe strongly, and in the case of everyone here thinking about your own organizations, in fact, how are you leveraging difference to make a difference? Some of you might have read a book called The Medici Effect. And the Medici Effect is written by someone by the name of Franz Johansson, who is a world-renowned consultant who specializes on innovation and inclusion. And the book itself, which is based on the Medici family, who were well-known influencers during the Italian Renaissance, speaks of something called the intersection. The intersection occurs when you get people of different backgrounds and capabilities, and through that, you achieve great outcomes. And this occurs in small and large basis in organizations of all sizes, and it probably occurs wherever you are, wherever you work. And it's something that's fundamental. The power of difference and leveraging difference to make a difference has actually even occurred very naturally when you consider two products that have changed our lives, the simple notion of the light bulb and the simple notion of the Macintosh computer. And in both cases, there's one common element. We know about Steve Jobs, we know about Thomas Edison, but do we know more about the people that made up the team that ultimately came up with the idea that ultimately changed the world? And when you consider that basic notion of taking a blank sheet of paper or building on ideas that might have already existed but finding new ways to exploit them further, again, that's very much what this symposium is all about. How do you take the ideas that you hear today? How do you take the conversations that have occurred between you at breaks, at meals, and turn them into greater opportunity? Part of our role at the USGA is ensuring that we are facilitating those kinds of ideas, those kinds of interactions, no different than the teams that were created here to develop something greater. And to the point, again, which is how do we leverage difference to make a difference in golf? Which brings us to this esteemed group here, British Columbia Golf. Now, this is a unique organization serving a unique market, which is the province of British Columbia. Let's learn a little about British Columbia Golf for a minute. So this is an organization that is very historic. It took two organizations to come together in 2004, and we'll learn about that in a minute. And the organization itself serves 300 golf facilities, 54,000 individual members. But what makes the organization unique, and quite frankly, unique in golf, as well as unique in generally in business, is the nature of inclusion that exists on the board of directors. Now, every organization around the world is asking itself the same question: how inclusive is the board? How effective is the board in serving its customers, in serving the members? And in this case, you have an organization who has far exceeded what most boards do, which is they've become consciously aware of how to be inclusive to serve their particular marketplace. Now let's talk about the demographics of British Columbia and how that connects to the board itself. So British Columbia, as an example, is about 4 million strong. As you'll see, as a country, it's evolving demographically both in terms of age, as you see in many developed nations, tend to be slightly aging as an overall population. But at the same time, you'll notice the diversification of those who live in this particular province, probably more so than any other province in the country of Canada. And this is the marketplace. This is the opportunity that this board is trying to serve. Now, if we take this one level further and we look at it through the lens of golf, what you can see is evolving golf participation that provides unique opportunity, which is really where the white space exists for this board and for the management of British Columbia Golf. Consider that 23% of the golfers in British Columbia are women, which actually is about the same when you compare about the 24 million golfers that are in the United States. Clearly, that is an opportunity to improve. The second area is the communities that this board represents and is trying to inspire and invite into the game itself. When you look at the overall percentage of participation by community, and by the way, I give enormous credit to Canada as a nation in terms of tracking this level of data, how does an organization led by this board solve for the question of how do we make the game healthy, continue to proliferate, and ultimately grow, and how do we invite and engage these unique communities? So with that, we're going to have a conversation about this, and let me introduce the members of the board. We have Patrick Kelly, we have Helen, we have Jolly, we have Michelle, and we have Chris, who is the executive director of British Columbia Golf. So let's give a hand for the group. So I'm going to start really with Patrick and Helen and Jolly and Michelle. And I'd like to start with a simple question of thinking about groups and thinking about difference as part of a unique board. The first question is, what do you bring to the table? What qualities do you bring? And ultimately, what kind of impact are you looking to make as a board member for British Columbia Golf?
Yeah, thanks, Steve. One of the things, I've done a lot of volunteer work, and you know, my skill set includes a lot of experience with governance, and you know, I bring that to the table, a lot of experience in executive levels and management and things like that. But that's not the particular focus of everything that started me in this role. Back in the year 2007, my cousin and I, who was Stephen Point, was appointed the first lieutenant governor for British Columbia, the Queen's representative for the province of British Columbia. And he and I were talking about trying to find ways to involve Aboriginal youth in particular in the game of golf, because he and I were avid golfers, we still are. And so he was saying, what can we do to enhance that? And part of the process that I went through, and I involved all of the 28 tribes in British Columbia, we actually formed a board called the BC Aboriginal Golf Association. And then as I was thinking about it, you know, I was the founding president, and I thought, okay, well, we better actually link up with the British Columbia Golf Association as I looked on the internet. And so I literally gave Chris Johnson a call, and you know, we ended up having a chat about what we were doing, and it was just perfect timing in a sense, because the board of BC Golf had passed a resolution saying that the association wanted to find ways to enhance the participation of Aboriginal golf. And I think what happened is Chris engineered a friendly takeover because you know, I got involved with British Columbia Golf, and to this day it's been an incredible relationship.
Okay, Helen?
Okay, so I bring my knowledge as a PGA professional, as well as I am the director of golf at Belmont Golf Course, so I bring my experience and my managing experiences as well. The most important thing that I can help with BC Golf is to understand the Korean background. Based on my experience, there is a huge market with the Korean golfers, but not enough that are a part of the associations. So what I try to bring to the table is how do we get them to be more involved with the associations?
Thanks, Steve. Good morning, everybody. In 2014, I got approached by Chris. Being involved in my Punjabi community since 89 through and 92, we bought association, Indo-Canadian Business Association, and where we were dealing among with federal government, provincial government with our business topics. Then we also started in 97 charity golf tournaments through Indo-Canadian Association, where we seen a big transition from 97 to now. In those days, I could say there was only few percentage of our community was involved. And now I can say there's 100% those tournaments are sold out through our community. And that transition came through also where we brought in 2010 International Punjabi Golf Association, where we got involved with other LA and Toronto. So all these affiliation brought actually more golfers closer to each other through networking. Mm-hmm. And where in these tournaments we see Punjabis and other communities got involved, and now we have golfers coming from Australia, India, UK, New Zealand, where it's a really built a big infrastructure. And when I got approached by Chris, it gave me a really, I was glad he did. It gave me a chance to be ambassador for golf and also to make it understand more how we can connect with each other, because it's almost over 300,000 South Asian community lives in BC. That leverage is really impacting now. I can see that. Where I can compare with you know, Punjabi Hockey Night in Canada, it started several years back. And we've seen a major growth in hockey. And if we apply same thing, connecting through, approaching through their local media, that is going to make a bigger change. And with their language, it's not they don't understand English, but the parents maybe not can understand. You know, I'm glad, you know, watching the rule changes, which can bring more relaxation or easy language to understand through younger generation. And also, I've seen a major transition through even back when I look at India. I see a great players like G. Milkha Singh and other, you know, Anirban. So it's a great transition, but it's outreaching to all the other ethnic groups through their language, through their media, can bring a major change to this game.
Okay, thank you. Michelle.
Mm-hmm. Good morning, everyone. Yes, I represent your 23%, but not so much. I'm that part that's missing, the other percentage that you're looking for. And so if 23% primarily is going to be the young female that's entering the game, playing at high performance, many of them are leaving the game in between and are not returning potentially until after their professional career or their husbands have picked up the game and that's the only way to spend time with them. They're joining it later. And so I represent that demographic that A, never started when I was young. I'm an athlete, I love sport. Of course, I think, and I have a strong enough or confidence because I've played sport to think that I could pick up a golf club and be like everybody else. But I am that person. I'm a mom. I have a 3.5-year-old at home. And so that is the demographic that we need to communicate with in order to figure out how are we going to get you back to the game once you're done being mom, or how are we going to get you in the game while you are a mom and bringing your child to the course. And so I'm going to be that person that the board can communicate with and then also kind of connect back to the community to develop the conversation. On my professional side, I bid on major international events. I have great relationships with our local government, but also bring a perspective from the event hosting side of things. So I'm able to translate a lot of the best practices that happen across other sports that can be applicable to golf, since it has typically just been set in its traditions or its tendencies of what it's been used to. And so I'm able to offer our board a little bit more conversation around that.
So, Chris, you have been in Canada since mid-80s, if I recall, and you've been the executive director of British Columbia Golf since the mid-90s. So you were very much involved in the merger of two organizations into the current organization. And one of the things we talked about was the fact that you started with a board collectively of about 50-plus people, and that board then morphed to a group of about 26, ultimately to a group of 9, then ultimately thinking through the lens of inclusion and using that as an opportunity to innovate, you brought it up to 12. It would be interesting to understand two things. One is, what were the drivers of the merger in the first place, and what was the process that the organization went through to consider board inclusion and ultimately to where we stand today?
Okay, well, I think as Roland indicated this morning, Golf Canada became the national sport organization in 2005. But provincially, all of the provincial golf associations have been the provincial sport organization, or PSO, for much longer period. And as such, in most of the provinces, we do receive a moderate amount of government funding, which comes with strings attached. You have to spend it in certain ways, and in our case, we have to spend it on increasing participation and excellence in the game. And the government came to us many, many, many years ago and said, you know what, if you are gender-specific organizations, you are not eligible for funding. So the Men's and the Ladies Association at that time created an artificial association, if you like, that met once a year to approve a combining of some financial statements, which we presented to the government and said that we were one organization. When Golf Canada and the Royal Canadian Golf Association and the British or the Canadian Ladies Golf Association, when it became clear that those two organizations were actively in discussions to merge, then the two organizations in British Columbia came together. And at that time, each of the organizations had roughly board sizes that were in the 25 to 26 range, which is where you come up with the 50. We brought everybody together. We agreed, and I will say that on both sides, we had highly enlightened leadership from a volunteer perspective that said, if we're going to do this, we're going to do it. We're just going to do it. We are not going to create a separate women's division. We are not going to do anything like that. We're going to bring everybody together. And the boards made a decision that it would be roughly 50-50 between men and women representation on the board, despite the fact that our membership levels were considerably different. But what each organization brought to the table was a balance sheet that was roughly the same size. So that made some sense. We came together. We knew 50 was ridiculously high for a board level. We also knew that 26 was a ridiculous number. But
you know, we're coming from operating boards and all kinds of different backgrounds, so we needed to make sure that everybody felt comfortable, that we could work well together. So we started with a board of 26, and we worked for a number of years to make sure that we correctly understood how to run men's and women's competitions at the same time, so that we could start amalgamating our course rating teams, so that men could rate women's courses and women could rate men's courses, and rules officials could work at championships for both genders. And that took a period of time while we learned the adjustment, and then with the assistance and the strategic help of the provincial government and the sport ministry, we started looking at, you know, best governance practices. We recognized that there was a movement towards smaller boards that were more policy oriented, and the board made a decision to come down to a board size of 9, which we did about 4 years ago. And that stayed in place for a couple of years, and then we started to look around, and we looked at a lot of the demographic figures that you put up on the screen, and we said, you know what? When we show the population of British Columbia who the board of the Golf Association is, it doesn't look like the same people that are out on our golf courses. And we need to change that. And we recognized that we couldn't do it in a reasonable period of time with only 9 people on the board. So we said to the nominating committee for British Columbia Golf, we want to increase the size of the board to 12. We want to use those 3 additional positions to make sure that we are more reflective of who actually plays golf in the province. So that's how we got to where we are today.
That's great. Thank you. Patrick, let's build on that. Maybe you could talk about an overview of the First Nations investment here in British Columbia, and where you've seen success and where you've seen some challenges in inspiring the community to get involved in the game.
Great. Thanks, Steve. The Aboriginal population of British Columbia is just over 200,000 people altogether. It's about 4% of the total British Columbia population. As you saw from the figures that Steve put up earlier, you know, some of the initiatives we've been working on have been successful because we got about just over 7% of the people participating in the game are of Aboriginal ancestry. So the Aboriginal people of British Columbia own 12 golf courses. And, you know, there's a lot of economic investment, there's a lot of employment, there's in not only in the Aboriginal community itself, as professionals, as people working in the industry, but it helps to build the relationships between the communities in particular, and that's been a very strong thing. You know, one of the challenges is integration, to be honest. You know, we've had an unfortunate history of colonialism in British Columbia, like North America, like much of the world, actually, and that's where some of the challenges come in. If you take a look, for example, at some things that happen at the home course where I play at Gorge Vale in Victoria, that course was set up in 1937, and literally adjacent to the golf course, it would be like having a fence here. And on currently hole number 4 is right here, and literally right there is the First Nation community. And for 77 years, there was no Aboriginal participation in the Gorge Vale Golf Group. There were no members, there were no people that played from the local community. And Esquimalt Nation is just another one nearby, again the same thing. They had no participation. And there were actually, one of the challenges came up. My wife and I moved to Victoria just over 6 years ago, and I was just out, and I decided Gorge Vale is a 12-minute walk from home, so I joined as a member. And I was out one day just practicing some chipping, and one of the members, a man by the name of Andy Relgic, comes up to me, and he says, "Do you know any of the local chiefs?" And I said, As a matter of fact, I do. I know the chiefs of Songhees and Esquimalt. I've known them for decades. And he says, you know, I think we could really use some help. And I said, oh, really? In what regard? He said, because every Friday and Saturday night, and it used to, hole number four used to be hole number six. And he said, every Friday and Saturday night on hole number six, kids jump over from the reserve and they play soccer on the green, they party. So, you know, we end up coming in on Monday morning and there's, you know, the greens are wrecked and there's the flag sticks broken perhaps. You know, so they had issues. And so I thought, okay, so why are you talking to me? I was joking about that. I said, well, yeah, that is an interesting problem. So I went to, using my relationships with the two chiefs and the elders, I went to them and said, you know, would you consider having your children come and join our juniors program? You know, because loads of us that are golfers there would love to be able to teach them, play with them, and, you know, get them involved in our juniors program. And, you know, they'd never been asked before in all the 77 years up to that point. And the reaction was very positive. And they said, wow, gee, really? And we said, yeah, absolutely. And so we now have 15 First Nation juniors involved in our juniors program. And, you know, they're just integrated in with everybody else and all the members, you know, play with them and help them understand the game. And, you know, we all provide them whatever we can to help them out. And the other interesting thing about that is the issues on hole number four, ever since we took this initiative, have totally disappeared.
Hmm. That's great. Thank you. Helen, you are the director of golf of a course that has a large Korean membership, and a question for you is, you know, what are some of the issues and opportunities in trying to bring golfers at the club level of different backgrounds together to participate in common events and activities?
So it's definitely an ongoing issue for sure. I feel like for example, at Belmont, we have 500 pass holders, and it's a type of membership. Out of that 500, 480 are actually Korean. So what I feel like I've done is I actually feel like I've come up with a solution that's obviously not going to be permanent because it's going to be ongoing. And what I've done is it's called the penalty program. Some people may agree with it, some people may not. So what I always make sure that I do is I'll watch the people that are, you know, breaching the rules or, you know, breaking the policies within the golf course. And instead of doing the traditional way of sending them a letter and letting them know that they're suspended for a week, I'd actually catch them on the spot and then I would bring them into the golf shop. Play would be suspended for the day. And then based on, I would do a quick calculation in my head of, you know, how much have they broken the rules and how much do they really need to be penalized for, and then I would implement a fee. And actually, to be honest, it's been very, very successful. And in the end, I found that because the communities are so tight, they all have their social leagues and their groups, if one person was to understand that they made a mistake, the entire community would find out within days. And it was actually interesting because I remember the very first time I implemented this, my mother actually found out that night at the swimming pool. So, yeah, and I found that I did earn their respect, and it definitely changed a lot for me. Hmm. So, yeah.
That's great. Thank you. Jolly, you know, to go back, you spoke about the International Punjabi Golf Association, which I'll admit the first time you talked about it, I had no idea it existed. And I think it would be helpful for the audience to understand the scope of the organization. And as a follow-up to that is, how do you reach folks in the community to be inspired and excited about the game? What does that look like?
Steve, it's very, just like Helen said, it's very close knitted community. Either they live in LA or Toronto or even India, they are connected to each other. Outreaching to them is so far it is on the personal level. In 2010, actually, when we bought this association, separate from business association, just as the International Punjabi Golf Association, the name we picked up because we want to bring internationally all these golfers involved under one umbrella with different associations. But outreaching them through our personal connection so far, and through the community media, mm-hmm. where we've been successful even in BC, using our own personal, along with the personal contact, we used Punjabi media, either it's print media or TV or radios, which has been actually really, really successful. And going back when Chris mentioned, like several years back, BC Golf Association had produced one of the CD where all, I think, different languages, they were stated with the rules of golf. And we put that CD contents on our website, which was really helpful explaining them the rules, how we play here in Canada. I know I visited back home. They play differently. They have a caddy along with them. Ball bounce out of bound, and they have a caddy to go and throw it out here. So it's, I said that those rules doesn't apply here. You have to play. It's education. I think reaching ethnic communities with their own language, it's a very, very effective tool. And also making them involved in their language, it's not, they do understand English, but making them involved, it gives them a sense, okay, we are part of it. That brings them more closer to the community and the game of golf. And also we experience another thing is bringing kids involved. Kids usually mentored by their parents. Mm-hmm. Mostly parents, they know their language, their native language. Educating the parents how their kids can learn the great manners through this game, it's really, really helpful. And it is a proven factor, actually, among our families, where we can see that effect, very effective. And we are having youth camps through our association. Where we have a summer camp where we get 25 to 40 kids, and out of those maybe 15 to 20 kids, they really get hooked up with golf. And not only the younger kids, also we see their parents get involved with golf. That's how we are outreaching them.
Okay, thank you. So Michelle, you've claimed that you represent two worlds, the world of young professional and women as golfers. And so maybe you could respond to both parts, which is, what do you see working and not working when it comes to attracting millennial generation to the game? And secondly, apply that same question to women in British Columbia specifically.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you know, what we see is the typical, it costs too much, or you know, it's a membership only, or it's gonna take up too much of my time. But in hindsight, I see it as an excuse. It's simply what, you know, Patrick just referred to. We haven't been asked. Like, simply just haven't been asked to come out as a professional. Most companies, and well, from my experience when I'm working, you know, if they buy a tournament sponsorship, they're going to get two teams, and they go through the office hallways, and they're going to figure out who can golf, and they're going to go up to the guys, and they're going to ask them, you know, are you going to be able to go out on the course today? Well, I'm at work. I have time to go. Like, I don't have the kids with me. This is my time. But nobody's asked me. And, you know, that first time happened, and it was my CEO of the convention center, and I was working there, and I was intimidated at first. And being a professional, of course, I'm afraid to be a beginner. I'm afraid to show that I don't know how to do something because I'm in the office trying to prove that I can do everything else and be, you know, amongst my colleagues. And so it inclined me to want to learn. And because I was asked, you know, even as a mom, you know, starting out now, the thing is I'm going to be following my child around. I'm going to be dropping them off. And what do I do when they drop them off? I'm dropping off at the golf course. Well, I'm going to go find my lessons. Is there packages when kids are learning for mom to be able to learn too at the same time? And I think that's really key, is to have the conversation with the females. The thing is, most of my girlfriends, we've had kids later. You know, we're not having them as 22-year-olds anymore as the children from my friends. And so we have that time as we're professionals to kind of figure out the game if we're going to be invited. You know, as an athlete, I just assumed I could pick up a set of clubs and go out and play. And I admitted it even at the dinner the other night. I still ask for my friends here to tell me what number to use when I'm out on the course. And I'm confident enough to stand there and say that. But the fact is, a tournament, you know, best ball play, I can join in with everybody else too. And as I've learned to play more with male colleagues, I learn a lot more. I also see as a professional, if there's female professionals, great, join me, but there's not too many playing. I don't want to play on a just women's team. I want the same benefits of business and golf, just like the guys, and the reason why you go out. So I'm going to go out on the course because I want to golf with my CEO, who happens to be a male. I don't want to have the all-women's team. I want to be on the mixed team. And so simplicity has been just ask. The females will come out. The more I talk to my girlfriends, the more they're like, I'm in. Like, and I've even said to Chris, when other sports are intimidating, and that's what you're saying, I represent both fields, and a lot of the intimidation factor for females getting involved are the obvious that have been stated. Something like triathlon is just as intimidating to get out there for the first time. So what have they done? I know in Vancouver, it sells out within minutes. There's my first try. And you know, it's not in the open water, it's in a pool, you know, for the swim, it's a shortened bike ride, it's a shortened run, and it's teaching people the fundamentals to get involved with the sport, and it's very successful. Well, I've never heard of my first tournament or my first round. I'm gonna put my hand up and say that right away, and I'm just thinking, like, whether you're male or you're female, there's a lot to learn when you go out into your first tournament or even just try to pick up a pair of clubs. And so, you know, it's where are those opportunities where there's adaptability to the game to introduce them. But I would love to see my first tournament or my first round of 18. You know, we're seeing it more and more. We've got my first shift for hockey now for some people to come out and play. And it's allowing you to not be afraid to be the beginner. And I think that's going to be key as you communicate with females and in general, just new golfers, even the males. I know my husband's staying home more with the children, and he's not golfing as much anymore. So, you know, what are you going to do to get them back in the game as that demographic starts to shift as mom's at work too now?
That's great. Thank you. You know, let me shift the focus inward for a minute. When we speak about being an inclusive board and having conversation around the table, whatever issues you're thinking about, whatever strategies you're looking to create, and you consider the differences that are represented on the stage here. Chris, when you think about what it takes to be successful as a board, what are you seeing in this board that is different, that has proven the case that by diversifying, it's in fact impacted the ability to serve the membership and maybe grow membership too?
Well, I think you just have a completely different dynamic in a board meeting than we used to have. You know, we're Canadian, so we have a big understanding of hockey as a sport, and you know, female hockey is a growing sport. As a matter of fact, it's one of the own the podium. Goals. I mean, we just expect that we're going to beat the United States and win a gold medal in women's hockey.
Just saying.
But, you know, and the Golf Association of Ontario started a wonderful program in conjunction with women's hockey, where they, during the winter, go into hockey arenas and work with the girls' teams to keep them together and try and move them from the arena in the wintertime to the golf course in the summertime as a group. So, you know, I would bring that to the board and we'd have a discussion and people would say, you know, well, that's a good program, you know, we should look at it. And Jolly says, well, you know, have you considered field hockey? It's exactly the same thing. You know, you have field hockey, they have male teams, they have female teams. You know, again, Jolly will come and he say, you know, like we do have some South Asian very good golfers. You know, do we promote those stories in the South Asian news? Do we go out into those communities and use those athletes as a way of, you know, generating interest? You know, Punjabi Hockey Night in Canada is huge. You know, golf can do exactly the same thing. You know, when you get into the Aboriginal community, you know, we worked for many, many years trying to get golf into the Aboriginal community, and they have a youth problem. 50% of their population is under the age of 25. Represents a huge opportunity. They've got billion-dollar investments in the sport of golf, and we need to help them create people that have the management expertise and the understanding of the game to manage those facilities on a go-forward basis. You know, through Patrick, we are now not trying to come in at the, you know, at the Aboriginal Friendship Center level and you know, actually run the programs ourselves, but we're talking at the chief level and it's coming back down and we're now working with their community to train their people to train the young people. And it just, you know, expands the program that much faster. You know, we want to talk with the Korean community. I mean, we have some wonderful, particularly women, young Korean golfers, but we're not seeing a huge number of just recreational golfers. And that's what our member clubs are asking us for, is how can you drive recreational golf? So, you know, maybe Helen can provide some insights as to how we can expand recreational golf in the female demographic.
Anybody else would like to add to that at all?
I know we're running out of time shortly, but, you know, I just want to comment about the impact of this kind of approach that you might consider. I know for a fact in the United States, you know, there's 4.5 million Aboriginal people in the United States. They own 50 golf courses in the U.S. There's another 20 that are being planned, and these are in 16 states at the moment. Probably another 4 or 5 to join. And you know, I think the opportunity in the United States is very much like the opportunity we're seeing in Canada and British Columbia. There's a million, just about 1.2 million Aboriginal people in Canada, and I know Roland and Golf Canada and some of the our sister organizations in the other provinces are also looking at these sort of initiatives.
Right.
In Mexico, I'm not sure what, I'm not as familiar with the situation in Mexico, but you know, I think if we take a collective effort across the board on these initiatives, I think we're all gonna be able to help one another out. And you know, having the courage to do it on a leadership basis is the main message, I think. And then, as Michelle's reinforced, let's ask each other. Let's say, what can we do to help one another?
Hear, hear. Thank you very much. I'm not sure if we have any questions.
We have one.
One question, okay.
And the question is, I'll try and summarize it here, but is it because this is just the right thing to do as fellow human beings, or could we really wait for local leaders to believe and act upon it? What are the most compelling arguments to be made to the mostly white, mostly baby boomer, mostly male local boards in the United States?
Wow.
Okay. And you've got a minute 58. Go ahead.
Right. I mean, I'll take a stab at it. You know, I think there is a business case for this, and you know, when you get right down to the bottom line, the numbers and the things that matter to the club owners and, you know, to the boards that are running them and to the associations, and you take a look at the competitive forces in the world of golf in Europe and Asia, and you know, you see there's an amazing interest growing in, you know, training programs and initiatives all across the world. And, you know, I think the case has to be made that we just harness the greatest amount of positive energy in all of our people and make the investments and make them work to the best of our ability collectively and individually. I know some of the club owners would love the opportunity to say we've helped them grow the membership base by, you know, 15% this year or even higher perhaps. So I think take a look at the business case, and when that works, the social case also works. You know, I think we connect those dots, but you have to have the courage to go there. You know, and I think it was Rand, he said, if you keep doing what you've been doing, you're going to get what you got. So.
Well, thank you very much for your commitment and for your leadership. So thank you.
Steve, if I can just say one thing before we finish. You know, we've not only innovated at our board level, we've also innovated at an industry level, and we work in very close partnership with the Allied Golf Association. One area that we do that is in Grow the Game initiatives, where we have come to the conclusion that there is no one organization that can do that. This year, 2017, is Canada's 150th birthday, and there is an organization in Canada called Participaction that encourages Canadians to get moving. And they have come up with a list of 150 activities that Canadians can do in order to get more physically active. Three of them involve golf. Regular golf, whether it's going to a golf course, going to a driving range, disc golf, or mini golf. And to help Canada celebrate its birthday on May the 28th, it will be Participation Day, Golf Day in Canada. And British Columbia Golf, along with our allied partners, are launching an advertising program that'll come out sometime around the Masters. And the goal is that we want to register 150,000 British Columbians to play 1.5 million rounds of golf over 150 days. And that's how we're going to celebrate Canada's birthday.
Lofty goals. Very good. Very good. Thank you, panel. I was going to say this is truly one of the great stories in Canadian golf, but it's really one of the great stories in golf, period. And you should all be congratulated for what you're doing and what you continue to do. Okay, we're going to break now. We'll have you back here at 11 o'clock. There are the kiosks are out in the lobby. The next panel discussion is a great one. It's going to be on equipment innovation, so please come back, and we'll see you at 11 o'clock.
Nine holes.
Early in the morning, before work.
Chasing the sun at the end of the day.
With my daughter.
Or with my dad.
Just playing nine holes is a great way to introduce people to the game.
It's an awareness campaign to just get the golfer to say, hey, instead of playing no golf today, maybe I'll just go out and play nine holes.
Come on, y'all. Let's play nine.
Buy your ticket to golf history as the game's grandest stage, the U.S. Open, comes this June to Erin Hills in the great state of Wisconsin. Limited tickets available only while they last. Visit usopen.com today.
We are in the home stretch here, and I just want to point out that after we've got two more sessions here, and then after that, there is still lunch available from 12 to 1, and a little later, if you're hanging around from 3 till 7, there's an activity taking place over at the One Under Golf Vancouver driving range, which is just around the corner. The directions are on your app. There'll be some food and drinks and a chance to hit some golf balls. Okay, right now we have a panel discussion on the coexistence of equipment innovation with regulation, and I'm going to hand it off to Dick Ruggie to introduce the panel and explain exactly what you're going to talk about.
Okay,
Dick?
Very good. Morning. Rand yesterday mentioned evolution of the game, and I've always looked at that as three evolutions of the club and balls, the equipment, the courses, and the players. All those things have been very much part of the game for six centuries. And they've kind of evolved together. And sometimes things happen quicker than others. And certainly equipment has had a period where it's accelerated the evolution, more of a revolution. We're going to talk about that and how the two sides, if you will, in this, being the equipment manufacturers, equipment retailers, equipment writers, equipment educators, and the equipment regulator, how they coexist. It's important that we coexist. I'm going to tell you who each of these folks are up here. Down the end, that's Raleigh Grove. He's here as a representative from the USGMC. That, of course, is the United States Golf Manufacturers Council. I often used to say that the one thing that golf club manufacturers disliked more than the USGA was each other. They're tough competitors. They're eating each other's lunch. Well, the USGMC has brought them together. They can work together on common interests. Raleigh was very instrumental in forming that group. He's the tip of the spear of that group, I would say, and has done very, very well for them. And that's why he's here today. Rather than trying to find some equipment manufacturer, just go to the USGMC and say, hey, give us a guy to come, or a person to come here. They sent their chairman, top notch. And of course, he's also employed by the Ping Company in very high level management role. And he also is, the L word, he's a lawyer, so. Next to him is Tom Mace. If you had somebody going to Cal Poly, San Luis Obispo, taking mechanical engineering, they'd be very, very lucky to have him as an engineering design professor. He's they often say that those who can do, those who can't teach. Well, Tom is certainly one who can, and he also does. He's a teacher and also has done very well in working at manufacturers in the design process early on in the phase. There are two phases of what we're going to talk about here in a little bit. The craftsmanship phase of golf equipment design, and that was from 1400 to maybe 1990. And then the engineering and science phase. Tom is very important in that engineering and science phase. Next to him is John
right.
Spitzer.
That's it.
John succeeded me at the USGA. So we had an easy act to follow, right? That's for sure. Which he'll remind me of that all the time. And he's been at the USGA for 20 years. He was my tip of the sword, I can tell you. I couldn't have done that job without him being there. And he's made it a smooth transition and has taken it to new heights. And that was, of course, to be in charge of the equipment standards department as well as the test center. Next to him, Mike Satura. Ever hear of a little publication called Golf Digest?
Please.
Well, Mike is
the equipment editor for Golf Digest. He's been there for 20 years plus, and most of that time has been as the equipment editor. I'm guessing he may be the longest term equipment editor at Golf Digest. Is that true?
Without question, and the scars to prove it.
Not surprised. At Golf Digest, there's no more important publication in the United States, at least, in golf than Golf Digest. And that role is a very important one. All the equipment manufacturers love to send him stuff and sell them on his ideas, so he'll write nice things. Now, Mike is a journalist, a dying breed. He gets the facts. He writes the facts, and he writes them well. Next to him, Lee Bader. Lee has been involved in commercial aspect of golf for over four decades. He's had a very successful retail golf shop and golf course for 35 years, something like that, a little bit more perhaps. And interestingly enough, most golf courses, you have a small retail operation that supports the golf course. He flipped that upside down. He's got a large retail operation with adjoining a golf course that supports the retail. Somehow that works. I first knew Lee about 25 years ago, not quite that perhaps, and he was the most innovative golf retailer in the country 25 years ago. He still is. Not very easy to keep that level. He's done it. He was Apple before Apple was Apple. And he continues to be very, very successful. He's fought off the big box invasion, and he's joined the internet invasion. He knows what he's doing. So this is quite a blue chip panel right here. And I'm going to start with Lee and ask him a question, because he's had the broad experience of the old days and the new days. What's the difference? How's it different today with modern versus the way it used to be, with the way clubs used to be designed, the craftsmanship era versus the new scientific era?
Yeah, thanks, Dick. Yesterday we had bunkerization, I think was a word. I think I represent ageification. I skew the average age of the speakers for the last couple of days down to the older side. I think that allows me to use notes, so forgive me. In the spirit of it's all about data, Dick, may I ask the audience some questions?
Go ahead.
Breaking new ground here. Who's 18 to 34 years of age out here? Not all that many, huh? How about 35 to 59? Sweet spot. How about 60 and up?
Yeah. I could qualify for ball.
Who in this room hits the ball too far? No hands. Who's re-whipped a wood?
Wow.
Wow, look at all the hands.
That's surprising.
Who doesn't have a clue what I'm talking about? Who would admit it? Who's worn Sansibelt slacks with Western cut pockets? Well, here's some relevant data from me. Thank you for sharing data on you. I'm the product of a service family. And I'm an only child. We moved five times by the age of nine, but when I was nine. That assured a few things. It assured that I was going to be a lonely kid. So at age five, my romance with golf officially started, and in an effort to not be lonely anymore, I built a golf course in my backyard. Had three holes. This is loosely speaking a golf course. One hole was a frozen orange juice can, another was a toy landing craft, and another was a hole in the ground near a rose bush. In today's terms, I think I would have put red stakes around the rose bush. It's pretty thorny. At the age of nine in 1963, my dad realized he was tired of losing golf partners as we moved so often. So he decided to teach me to play and bought me a set of clubs. A set of Chandler Harper Jr. golf clubs. Has anybody heard of Chandler Harper Jr.? Look at this, you win the prize. Under your seat is a prize. The type of store we bought it in was pretty interesting. You could have bought fish food, fresh fried chicken, and a puppy on the way out the door after we bought the clubs. So let's fast forward to 1973 when my romance with the business of golf began. I was about 5'10½". That was in 1973. I was 24 years old. So 5'10½" now, I'm lucky to sniff 5'9". So I've shrunken a bit. I used to play the gold tees. Now I play the purples unabashedly. I had a Powerbill Persimmon driver, which for those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, it was wood. I now use a Ping G driver, Raleigh. Irons, I used Hagen. We used to call them butter knives, very thin bladed clubs. I used Ping G irons, Raleigh.
Good man.
Balls were kind of interesting. I called them poison ivy balls. We used to just hunt in the woods and get poison ivy every year, and that was the brand of balls that we used to say it was. Now I use multi-layer, really fancy balls. Back then I was pretty healthy. I used to hit 500 balls a day out of a bushel. Today, not so much. Grams of things. Grams back then was the cracker you used to eat before bed. Now I have 70 grams shaft. That's really light. My driver distance, and I guess this is getting to the point, was about 250 yards back then. And today it's 255. So the moral of that story for me is that it's kept my interest in the game very high. So I guess an operative question is, how does the consumer who lives in a Moore's Law world react to the tradition narrative and the USGA design limitations? And I think I'll pass it back at that point.
Okay.
Well, Dick, before you go on, Lee said that he started out and his driving distance was 250, and now he's hitting at 255, so it's quite obvious that regulations haven't hurt innovation, and so I think we can call this. Any questions?
We're done. Thank you. Or you could look at it as somebody who's as close to the industry's development, and you could see that the reason you've maintained distance is because equipment has certainly improved, but it's also improved at a personal level. So in other words, it's much more likely today than ever before that not only is the equipment better, but it's gotten better at getting you better in a way that might be different, that could get me better, or John better, or Raleigh better, or Tom better. So I think there's this idea of innovation is sort of this perception of a straight line going up constantly in one direction, and sort of focused on this thing, this club or this ball being X percent better than the last club or ball. And I think really where innovation is today is the golfer has a greater potential to be X percent better than he was yesterday because of this sort of combination of elements of innovation.
I'd like to bring Tom into the loop here. Tom, being an engineering professor, the kind of person I used to tremble with fear from back 50 years ago, I don't anymore. I like Tom. He is representing, if you will, being the one who both teaches engineering design principles by using golf equipment as his medium to his students, and also be one who has been very successful in actually working with golf club companies and creating designs. Not just golf, but engineering, part of engineering is living in a world of constraints, whether it's cost constraints or strength of materials constraints or size constraints, whatever it is. And certainly golf has those constraints, and some of those are imposed by the rules. And I'm interested in if you see the constraints imposed on golf clubs as being either a burden or an opportunity in the world of design.
Thanks very, very much, Dick. You're very kind in your introduction. So, and thank you to the USGA and Golf Canada. And I'm happy to be here because when I came off the flight
I said, oh, it's the RCGA that is helping put this on. And it dates me a little bit on my playing days. So, but yeah, I first got into the equipment side of things 20 plus years ago, right when the things were taken off. And we did things that seem obvious to us today. You know, measuring the center of gravity was something that wasn't a foregone conclusion. Now we measure the center of gravity to validate the CAD model. And a lot, there was product then that wasn't that computer-aided design based. We hadn't even got to moment of inertia yet. And now that's one of the most common points that we talk about on a regular basis. And even back then we had the launch monitors, but that was something that's proliferated and made everybody aware of the launch conditions being so critical. Over those years, the tools have come in to play in this R&D circles. And Dick says, I work with students and I always have students, you know, Dr. Mace, I want to do golf stuff. And I always go, are you sure you want to do golf stuff? And but they do. But the little science slice where I live in this industry is quite technical. I had automotive background, so I brought in the explicit finite element analysis that does the impact problems that are key to golf. And one of the first students who built my air cannon at Cal Poly was just loved golf. Well, he's at Lawrence Livermore National Labs now. And you know, he's extrapolated this to bunker busters and other things that he'll never tell me about that are secret in nature. So it's very high tech now. We have advanced material models. The ball has to be modeled with these fancy models. The impact and just testing to get the properties, because I can't call up a ball company and say, hey, I'm doing this research. Can you give me the properties of your ball? That's not going to happen. So just like my student who went to the Livermore National Labs, which is one of our defense labs, they're secretive. The golf industry's very secretive as well, protecting the technology. It's not easy to build these models, to validate these models, and to go forward in those ways. And so, in a sense, if I put on my kind of the observer academic, there's tensions, and you know, we have fun at these, we know each other, we laugh and we yuck it up, but there's kind of a tension, like a good tension at your club when you're going to play for the club championship. You know, there's a little bit of a tension of that competition. Tensions that we see are in, you know, company to company. Everyone's trying to get that product out there. And then there's a company to the USGA to get conforming and to try to get these really good ideas that are going to create sales that will pay R&D people salary. And then there's a tension the other way, USGA to the companies, because you receive some arrows as well every once in a while.
Uh-huh. Absolutely. Raleigh shot a couple of them.
Right in your back. Yeah.
And then, you know, I also think that there's consumer tensions. You know, there is a perception that there's a lot of fluff in what people read in the magazines and all that. So it's these tensions are there. That's why it's challenging for us to come up with these answers. So back to the question is is this regulation a burden or an opportunity? And so I think, you know, there are ways you can look at it both sides, but I would think, you know, there are innovations, like there's always this challenge of, is this going to be conforming? So there's time and effort that goes into that to validate, you know, to say, okay, is this okay? Are we going to be okay on this? You know, we have this design and we think it'll really help slow swing speed players, but then there's always that threat that the advanced players will get an advantage as well on that. And so there's some a burden, as Dick put it, that's there as well. The opportunities, of course, you know, us engineers, constrained problems, we're always looking for, wow, that's really clever. You know, you always look for that design that's like, holy cow, you know, I wish I had thought of that. But the in sometimes I think that the constraints are the they slow innovation a little bit, but we all are in the game of golf and we want to keep it the game of golf. So if I summarize this, the engineering work is really advanced now in the engineering companies. I think they're pretty close to designing drivers that are this close to yielding through normal use. And it's a little bit of a technical term, but they can build stuff on the edge now. Just saying that the people are good at these companies. I wouldn't call it a burden so much as a shared responsibility. I think, you know, I think everyone on all sides looks at it as a shared responsibility that we have, and we all want to advance, you know, our particular ends of things, but we understand that this dance is going to go on for a while, if I might put it that way. So,
well, I mean, from my perspective, I'd say what's really compelling about that dance is that the speed with which innovation can happen. You know, there were several presentations that talked about failing fast, and there is no segment in golf that fails faster and succeeds faster than the equipment end of things. And I think, you know, whether it's CAD models or rapid prototyping or you know, launch monitors that immediately tell you, hey, this is a higher spinning driver and it's going the wrong direction. The ability to know not only that something is not good, but it's leading you down an incorrect path is instantaneous today. And I think that's, at the end of the day, that's the huge winner in all of that is the golf consumer. And if you want to include in that group elite players who are benefiting from that technology probably more than, at least more directly and more immediately than some average golfers.
So our consumers, which is everybody in this audience, covet distance. If golf was an opera, the driver would be the diva. Can we look forward to having more solos in the future?
His answer is no.
Now let me touch on that just a little bit by bringing Raleigh into this. And Raleigh works for a company that has a long history of innovation, business success, and I'll say tension with the USGA. Pin Company has all those things, and they continue to have all, certainly the success, and certainly the innovation, and hopefully the tension is lessening. I feel like it did during my time there, and I think it probably continues to be better and better. And I was talking to Raleigh, how their company continues to be successful, and they continue to have great innovation, and I said, what's your secret sauce?
Thank you, Dick. I appreciate that kind introduction. I would prefer to think of it as constructive assistance. First of all, let me clarify that while I'm involved in the USGMC, I'm not speaking on behalf of them. Trying to get all those cats herded together to agree with everything I'm going to say, impossible. Won't do that. I'm also speaking on behalf of myself personally as opposed to on behalf of my role with Ping. With that said, the secret sauce would have to be passion. Passion for innovation, passion for building a better golf club, passion for excellence. And I have the opportunity and had the opportunity. I've been there almost a quarter of a century. I had the privilege to be able to work with Carsten Solheim, our founder, and John A. Solheim, our chairman and CEO, and now the third generation, John Kay and the others. And that is a consistent passion. That's something that we've continued to work for. And you know what? Money follows. The first thing that happens, build a better product. And that is just something that has been ingrained into us. With respect to the tension and the rules, I want to open the curtain a little bit, because I know you know all the history. I'm not talking about the Groove litigation unless somebody drags me into it. But a couple decades before that, we were selling clubs, being Carsten and John. And Carsten put a bend in the shaft because it was way easier to square it and to bring it around. It was really easy to hit with a bend in the shaft. Well, they ended up getting a pronouncement from the ruling bodies that said it's no longer conforming. And at that moment, business went to zero. Okay, so that was in Carsten Solheim's heart, his experience and what happened, and it was scary. Anytime you have business risk, unexpected, whether you fail quickly on innovation because of CAD, that is a business risk that was unexpected, and that was difficult for them. But thankfully, he had invented this little putter, maybe somebody's heard of, it was called Answer. And what we did is we straightened the shaft on the Answer, and those things sold like hotcakes. And so we survived, but business had gone to zero and straightened the shafts. I'm gonna fast forward over the Groove litigation, go to 1998, and I was standing on a little hilly mound at the Olympic Club in June. And we were waiting. I was with Mr. Solheim, my boss. Ely Calloway was standing next to me, my counterpart at that company, and several others. And we were waiting for David Fay to let us know whether our driver was going to be on the right side or the wrong side of the line. That was an anxious moment. As you know, we put millions of dollars into research and development and all these things. And it wasn't just that moment. It was all those months leading up to that June day when we were wondering what was going to happen. So it's real. Manufacturers are real people. We bleed. It's a business risk that we try and mitigate. Now, I'm going to let you into something else that probably nobody here is really, well, a few people are aware of it, but not many. We have a very unique environment legally. And by the way, I'm not an antitrust lawyer, and I don't pretend to be, but I do have counsel that I use. But we're in a unique environment legally where we have a more difficult time dealing with a third party, not the USJ specifically, just any third party, than dealing with the government directly. And let me take you back and tell you, in late 70s, there was a golf ball company called Polera. And there was a group of manufacturers that got together. And the allegation goes in the complaint that they had agreed on where the line was going to be on technology. And that's what we're talking about right now. And Polera was not in the club. They're on the outside. So they sued. And I understand people wrote checks. Okay, that's a foundation, and there's antitrust law that the industry had to look at. And let me tell you what antitrust law basically, once again, I'm not an expert, but it's two or more actors that agree to the negative impact of the market. Okay, so think through that when I'm saying what I'm about to say. So, ironically, and I can't believe I'm saying this, but it's easier to deal with the government than a third-party non-government organization, okay? And the reason is that they have rules for transparency, they have congressional hearings, they have judicial review, and hey, you can even vote them out if it gets really bad and you have a major constituency that will do that. But they also have what's called an antitrust exemption, which means at the United States Golf Manufacturers Council, I can get together with all the other manufacturers and we can petition a government, and we do it all the time, on anti-counterfeiting issues. We found out that Ping, dubious honor, one of the most counterfeited brands on the planet, not just brands in golf, brands on the planet. And so we have been petitioning, whether it's the US government or Chinese government, and working there. We can't do the same with the rulemaking bodies. And so where does it go? And John, you'll probably laugh at this, but it's a little bit of, John and I are doing a tango on stage. I apologize for the unwanted visual, but we need to be able to appropriately communicate, but the group of manufacturers can't get together and say, hey, John, you gotta relax it just a little bit on that. You gotta make it faster. You gotta make it whatever. So what we do is we deal with process and transparency and make sure that we have a good process and that we understand what's happening. And I just want to thank the USGA, John and his team in particular, for meeting with us, Mike Davis for supporting things like this. And going all the way back to Vancouver, same city, great thing happened 2010. We had a rules forum. We had a protocol that came out of that in 11. And it's wonderful to be able to work together to figure these things out. Because there is a tension, as I told you, there are some legal barriers for how we do that. But I guess what I'd like to say is our company, starting with Carson Solheim, going out there and asking pros how he could make the product better. We've listened to constructive feedback through the years. It's made Ping a better company, it's made our products better. And for those who have the courage to be able to constructively communicate with the rulemaking bodies, I believe that that brings a better product as well.
Very good.
I mean, John, do you think the level of communication between manufacturers and the USGA is in a fundamentally different place today than it was even, say, pre-groove rule or certainly 20 years ago with the COR situation?
Yeah, Mike, absolutely. And I think that if you looked at the two things you just said, the COR situation, it was probably about as bad as it could get from the standpoint of our relationship with manufacturers. I think the Vancouver Forum, which we call that happened in this city, as Raleigh said, just a few years ago, was really a great moment for coming together. We adopted a set of protocols that we're trying to live by as best we can. We still have some growing to do. All in all, I think our relationship has improved. We're trying to be more transparent on how we do the business. And I think that it really isn't tension. It's more like we have kind of a mutual respect. The manufacturers respect the rules. They, for the most part, we do apply a little bit of a burden to them from a time frame. They got, you know, they rush through the design process and everything trying to get product to market, and then they have to send this stuff to the USGA, and we try as hard as we can to get them a ruling as fast as possible so we don't disrupt their design and manufacturing curve. But it's improved drastically since that Vancouver forum, and Ping was one of the lead drivers to getting that done and bringing all of the manufacturers together along with the USGA and the RNA to try to heal these wounds that kind of had existed from before.
Well, thank goodness he didn't say it's gotten a lot better in the last 4 years.
He said that to me personally.
Okay. Mike, I have a question for you. You know, you get shown all kinds of product all the time. You know, that's what people are pitching to you. And you have to cut through the chaff and get to the reality and the facts. You know, what do you think the needle between perceived and real benefits, you think that's swung one way or the other? Do you think that constraints have pushed that one way or the other? What's your view of that?
Well, as someone who has not played five rounds of golf in the last 20 years with the same set of clubs, I have a hard time really remembering what reality is, at least as far as it comes to my game. But I do think that we're in a different age of innovation. So I think, you know, up until maybe 2 or 3 years ago, innovation was really about the specific product, the club or the ball. I think innovation has moved in a different direction. I alluded to this a little earlier that, you know, whether it's adjustable drivers, whether it's 20 different loft and bounce options on a wedge, or you know, 6 different kinds of irons from the same company, the possibility of a golfer finding that sort of golden set of clubs that's going to make them play better is greater and more possible, and that's where real improvement is going to happen. So yes, is there a hard and fast limit on COR, and we can talk about how distance at the elite level has been relatively flat, and the perception among consumers could be, well, innovation is over. And I think what we've forgotten is that making it possible for somebody to hit the ball farther is more than just making the face more flexible. And that's what designers have done. Okay, we have drivers that fundamentally launch the ball differently today than they did 5 years ago in terms of higher launch and low spin. We have drivers that are fundamentally more capable today to match my particular launch conditions versus John's particular launch conditions. So we're in, and then we have diagnostic tools that make that more possible for me to know whether the latest product is as good as what I have or better. So I think we're, you know, when you talk about innovation and constraint, there's this idea of, yes, you've constrained the object, but I don't think, and I hope it never happens, that you really haven't constrained the golfer's ability to take advantage of that technology.
So would you like to know how many people in this audience have been fit?
I would like to know how many, and if it's more than half, it would be a staggering number.
Who's been fit to a set of clubs in the last couple, 3 years?
Very good.
That's encouraging.
That's encouraging.
Yeah, that's encouraging.
But you've told me in years past, you've been at golf organization gatherings and walked down the row of bags and been
junk.
So the thing is, there is this possibility that's way out there. I mean, 2 years ago, I was part of a research project just to kind of quantify how poorly fit golfers are. And the average golfer, based on our study of golfers' launch conditions, is leaving 23 yards on the table, okay? Now that doesn't have anything to do with the average golfers are playing persimmon. It has to do with the average golfers playing the wrong equipment. I think if the needle is, it's not so much where the needle is swinging in terms of perception and reality for improvement. I think we're in a different gauge now, okay? And I think that's the challenge that manufacturers are seeing. I think, in a way, it may be a challenge for the rulemakers to decide, you know, how much freedom are we allowed in terms of adjustability, or how much freedom are we allowed in trying to constrain the golfer?
Well, let me lead that in right in with John. John, we're in a world that's accustomed to new products, all the time. iPhone syndrome, you know, you always expect something better and better. And how do you see regulation fitting into that world that expects more and better all the time?
Well, I think that it's fit in quite nicely. I think we've drawn some lines around what extent it can go, but you can see it's quite evident that the manufacturers have been able to innovate quite a lot within the boundaries that we've set. Ultimately, when you're in a sporting endeavor, you're trying to test your physical skills and your physical abilities. And while we sometimes refer to recreational golf and competitive golf, if you're putting pencil to a scorecard, it's really competitive golf. You may be just playing against yourself, but ultimately, it's competitive golf. And one thing that's a pretty indicative of some of the innovation within the golf industry is if you were to go onto the U.S. patent website and you go and look at the various sports and you say, how many patents are there that have cricket in the title, or hockey, or swimming? And you say, you know, cricket, there's like 30 patents since 1976. 1976 is when we put in the overall distance standard for balls. And then we have 200 for skiing, and then we have 800 for soccer, and then we have about 800 for hockey, and another 1,200 we might have for tennis. Where does golf fit into that big picture of that? Well, there's 21,000 patents for golf in that time frame. So it's kind of hard to consider that there's not been any innovation, or they're protecting an awful lot of old stuff if that's the case. So,
and may I tag on that, on the intellectual property? I do feel for the USGA in this, because even if you loosen a rule, you're picking a winner or a loser. There's somebody that has IP out there, and if you loosen a rule, and I know that's counterintuitive. It's like, let physics be the guide. I'm a manufacturer, right? But if you loosen it up, there could be somebody that has IP in the non-conforming space, and you have just chosen them to be economically successful. So you have to be careful through this minefield on how we do it. I'm not making an argument for not loosening, certainly. But I'm just telling you that people don't think through all the issues that they have to deal with, because IP is a major focus.
And I mean, I think the other thing that we all talk about especially in what I do, is how the perceived limitations of the rules have been inspiration for innovation, sort of outside the box of the rules. And I'm not talking about innovation in a non-conforming way. I'm talking about innovation in a way that says, okay, we know we're limited here, so instead of trying to innovate in this very closed space, let's think about, well, okay, they've set the rules on grooves. Is there a better way to design grooves through the set of lofts that are encompassed across wedges? Well, some people think there is, and so they've come up with, well, the grooves should be narrower and deeper on lower lofted wedges, and they should be wider and less deep on higher lofted wedges. Are we also able to innovate in a way that makes it more likely that my wedge swing makes cleaner contact with the ball? And so there are a lot of manufacturers right now who, as horrified as they were by the groove rule, believe that the wedges they make today are more effective. They don't spin more, but they're more effective for golfers, again, if they're properly fit to them, than wedges from the early 2000s and up to 2008 and 9, because manufacturers were only focusing on, let's make the sharpest, deepest, squarest groove we could make. By boxing that in, engineers have been freed to think about what else can we do to take advantage of the situation.
So, Mike, what I'm hearing you say is that the new rules come into place by the USGA, and that spurs new equipment sales. So should equipment companies be asking for new rules?
Oh, I'm sure they're asking for new rules, but not the rules that you're thinking they should be asking for.
So John Solheim said to me, I enjoyed the answer to this question I asked him behind the scenes. John Solheim said to me one day that physics is the ultimate arbiter. And I guess it's a two-part question. What's the delta between where we are now and where physics limits it? And if it's not a lot, why do we need limitations?
Well, you have to kind of parse that question right away with, does it have to look like a golf club or can it be an air gun? And, you know, if we're still playing golf, you have to have a rule that looks like a golf club. So you can't get rid of all the rules, period.
Right.
From a physics standpoint, if you were just to look at the spring-like effect, the coefficient of restitution on how fast the ball comes off the club, if you went up to 0.9, which is like a 90% efficient impact, you might gain another additional 10 yards from where we are now. There's also some gains that might be able to be made from aerodynamics in golf balls or perhaps new materials in golf balls or golf clubs, graphene or something that Tom Mace and his colleagues may come up with. So there is room to grow from that area. But to bring back to what Mike said, it's an excellent point, and one of the really big advantages, or one of the big things that was developed as a result of a rule, is the club and the spring-like effect. So in 1998, when we had and put those limits on for the COR, there was really very few companies that had that on the radar. TaylorMade, which Dick had been working on at the time, it was on their radar, and it was on a radar of a company in Japan. And what happened is when this came to light, the manufacturers put all of their research and development and all their technical skills and came up with brilliant new materials and manufacturing methods that were really able to get the, as Tom had said, things right to the limit of yielding. So it was able to give the consumer the best product they could get within the limits of the rule. So in that particular instance, just like the grooves, and we're seeing this now, those kinds of limitations focus the efforts of the research and development teams at these manufacturers to, hey, how can we make the best product and get right up to that line that it's going to conform to those rules, but give the consumer the best product that we can provide?
I think it's really impressive.
Our clock is ticking.
I think it's really impressive that if you ask any age group of golfers, they still want to play by the rules. And I think, this idea that there's a 0.9 out there that we could somehow manufacture and get 10 or 15 more yards. Let's remember what I just said about 10 minutes ago. The average golfer's already leaving 23 yards on the table. So he doesn't need non-conforming equipment.
Lightning round. Quick question for each of you, and a one, two-word answer. If you had one equipment rule to change, not you, John, one equipment rule to change, what would it be?
17 clubs in the bag.
No surprise there from the seller.
More
Mike,
toys.
Go ahead, Mike.
Initial velocity standard.
Okay. Tom?
I'd drop COR.
Okay. Raleigh?
I can't limit it to one.
No, you only get one. You only get one.
I liked that, 10 yards.
You got one?
Do I have one?
No, not you. I'm not giving you a chance. Are you kidding?
No, I can't look at it. Like, what's my favorite band?
Well,
you know?
We only have 30 seconds, so we don't really have much time for questions, but we're happy to take them if you have one there.
There's really a couple here, but I'll just get to one here then. Okay. In 10 years, what does the average driver look like? What will be different than the current state, and how much further will it drive the ball? Look off to the future.
Well, Mike, I think we kind of answered what it could do, but in 10 years, it will drive the ball no more than 320 yards when hit at a club at a speed of 120 miles an hour in a launch conditions of 10 degrees and 42 revolutions per second. So.
Anyone else?
Honestly, I think.
Glad you asked.
I think there's a possibility that the average driver will get lighter with the shaft, while maintaining a head weight that is still in the 195 to 200 gram range. So therefore, we have a possibility of average golfers to move the club head faster. And we have with adjustability, we have an average possibility for average golfers to move the club not only faster, but more efficiently. They hit the center of the face more often, and maybe they're not leaving 23 yards on the table.
And of course, adjustability was brought to the world of golf by the USGA. Changing the rules. That's true.
Gentlemen, thank you very much. Great panel
thank
discussion.
You.
For
thank
those
you.
Of the questions didn't answer, I'm sure they'll be around for you after. Awesome. A lot of love on this stage. A lot of love. Gotta like it. All right. We just have one more speaker, and that's the guy who started things off yesterday morning. Please welcome back to the stage the CEO of USGA, Mike Davis.
Well, listen, thank you for the last day and a half for your attendance. This has been I think everybody would agree, a really enlightening couple days, and there's a lot of people that have been involved in this, but I've been asked to close this up really to focus on the title of what this has been. It's been an innovation symposium about imagining the future. Before I get into that and say a few words and really imagine, dream a little bit, let me again say thanks to some people, some organizations that have made this happen. First of all, to Golf Canada and the Mexican Golf Federation, thank you. It's wonderful to have been here in Canada. The hospitality has been superb, and let's do it again sometime in the future. To the British Columbia Golf Association, thank you. You too have been gracious hosts. To our speakers that have been out there, I think everybody would agree, we've learned all kinds of insights, and really has been a wonderful balance of what we were trying to get out of this week, which is really focusing on the golfer experience and also what we can do for golf facilities in terms of helping them with their sustainability long term. I have to thank my fellow staffers here, and I'm not going to go through name by name, but folks, this was your vision. You made it happen. Good job with it, and thank you. And then last, to all the attendees, this simply wouldn't be possible without having you here. And I dare say we've got a lot of key influencers in the room. And you know, what we really hope you do is when you leave here, you do exactly that. You help influence. You focus on making, you know, passing the word about golfers' experience and about really helping golf facilities long-term make sure they sustain. Because as we talked about at the beginning, or I talked about, it's not just growing the game. It's making sure that we grow a game into something that's very welcoming and enjoyable. So you've heard from many of the speakers, great work with everything you've done, and I hope leaving here that everybody's had something that you've been able to take away, whether it's an idea, a piece of information, or a new tool that really does help affect the future in a positive way. And I guess as we get into that, what I really want to do now is imagine a little bit in the future. Because, you know, folks, we have a game here that is almost 600 years old. In North America, the games, you know, started in the late 18th century, and so it's roughly 125 years old. If you think about the innovation that's happened in that period of time, I mean, when we got here, if you think about the golf courses have grown. Next year, we're playing our U.S. Open at Shinnecock Hills Golf Club in Southampton, New York. It's going to be about a 7,500-yard test. In 1896, when we played the U.S. Open there, guess how long that test was? About 5,500 yards. When you think about what, and just imagine, because we don't actually know, but imagine what the maintenance practices would have been at Shinnecock Hills in 1896. Can you imagine the likes of, you know, this is even after 1896, but think about if Bob Jones came back, or Francis We Met, or Glenna Colette Vare. If they got out to one of our golf courses right now and saw the fairways, if they saw the greens, they wouldn't even think the grass was real. It's amazing the innovation. Think about the clubs. You know, 600 years ago, it really started out with some type of implement that you were hitting something round. And that really ended up being mostly sticks hitting stones into rabbit holes. We've progressed. I mean, then it was wooden clubs hitting leather balls filled with feathers. Now we've gotten into these high-tech clubs. We're using distance measuring devices. Who knows what's going to happen in 20 years, 50 years, or 100 years? But I think that, you know, the key message is here, golf has always innovated. But we have to be true to what the principles of the game have been. And sometimes those are at odds. You just heard some of the things that I think golf has traditionally had to deal with, some of the pushes and the takes. So it's interesting. As a nonprofit organization, I will tell you that we think about these things. We have the luxury of probably being able to think more long-term than most of society. Think about organizations, think about for-profit businesses. The way society has gotten, and as quickly as it moves, you're thinking about next quarter, thinking about what the year's gonna be like. If you're really forward-thinking, you may be thinking 3 to 5 years in advance. I know at the USGA, we think a lot about, you know, what's 2017 going to be. We've got a lot of things we have to execute on this year. We have a five-year strategic plan. But one of the things I will tell you we're doing, and it's our responsibility to do, is think about what is the game going to be like in that 10 years, in 25 years? What might it be like in 100 years? And you can only imagine, and I think that as we look through some of those things, knowing some of the pressures, knowing that we want to have golfers have a good experience. We want to make sure golf courses are sustainable. And we want to make sure that we respect the traditions of this wonderful game we all love. But at the same time, I think that we realize if we're stagnant, the game is really not going to thrive. It may just survive. So I think that we go through this. And as we look into that future, I think we really do feel like the game deserves to have strong leadership. Sometimes the decisions that get made are not easy. When I think back of some of the things where, you know, we all have regrets in life. When I think about some of the things that have, the USGA has done over the years, and one that comes to mind is the whole distance issue. You're hard-pressed, anybody is hard-pressed to say that as distance has increased the way it has in the last 100 years, that that's been good for the game. We all want to hit the ball further. We get that. But distance is also relative. And you think about the billions and billions of dollars that have been expensed or spent to change golf courses. And you say, has that been good for the game? Has the fact that Shinnecock Hills went from 5,500 yards to 7,500 yards, what has that done good for the game? Now, it's increased the expenses to maintain it. It's cost, you know, us time to extra walk an extra 2,000 yards. But you say, what has that done? What's that actually done? And so I think as we look to the future, we need to be open to what is in the best interest of the game and those that play the game. Because ultimately, that for the USGA is our mission. It's about the betterment of the game and for those who play it.
I guess as we close this innovation, what I'd like to do is what I've been asked to do is just try to imagine a little bit. So think about this. Imagine golfers, and this is a perception thing, but imagine golfers changing their perceptions where hard doesn't necessarily equal good. For the last half century in North America, there's been this mindset that hard equals good. But what we really need to do is say your golf experience, an enjoyable golf experience, equals good. So this notion of continuing to make the golf courses harder, longer, narrower, higher rough, force carries, lost balls, et cetera, that probably isn't going to add to that enjoyable experience. So I think that there's a perception where you say what we want is an enjoyable experience, not necessarily a harder experience. Another one, can you imagine the perceptions of golfers if this notion of dark green grass, perfectly manicured and groomed, overwatered, wasn't necessarily perceived as good? What's wrong with a little tinge of brown to the grass? What's wrong with a course where the balls bounce? A bouncier golf course, folks, is a far more interesting and strategic golf course, and it's not just for the elite player. The average golfer, the beginning golfer, when a golf course is drier and you can get a little bit more extra roll in your drive or you can bounce balls into greens, that makes for a more enjoyable experience. So this notion of everything has to be lush and green, we should disband that. I know when we had the back-to-back opens at Pinehurst in 2014, it was fascinating the feedback we got. Because number one, I would say that of the 156 men and 156 women, overall, they loved how the golf course played. They loved the bounciness. They didn't care that there was a brown tinge to it. But the feedback we got, at least in the United States, was at best marginal. People wanted to see a dark green, perfectly manicured, overwatered golf course. That can't be the future of the game, not the way water's going to be. As Rand talked about yesterday, imagine just different perceptions with maintenance practices. So if you can imagine fairways that aren't cut as tight as they are right now, where players, as Rand mentioned, can actually get the ball up in the air easier, where you're not seeing golfers' skull pitch shots from around the greens. Rough that's not cut as high. I love to tell the story, and we had the U.S. Amateur at Marion Golf Club in Philadelphia in 2005, followed by the Walker Cup in 2009. The fairways for those two events were mown at a quarter of an inch. If you've ever played on a quarter of an inch, that ball is right against the ground. So we decided in the spirit of trying to do something right for the game that we were going to raise the mow height for the 2013 Open to a half an inch. So you went from a quarter inch to half an inch. You're saying to yourself, it's only a quarter of an inch, but it's doubling the height. When a ball is a quarter inch, it is against the ground. You really have to be able to pinch it. And when it's a half an inch, it gives the average golfer a chance to actually get their club under the ball. And you know what the net result from that was? That when we played at Marion and that U.S. Open, I was actually worried that we're going to get some negative comments from the players saying, I'm getting flyers out of the fairway. Didn't get one negative comment. But you know what it did for Marion's members and their guests? They loved it. And they've never gone back from it. And it's just an example of just a perception where, whether it's green speeds, I mean, think about this. If we can change, if we can imagine where fast greens weren't perceived to be great greens, we just heard yesterday, fast greens cost more to maintain. They're more prone to disease. They, in some cases, we've seen architecture change in greens because the greens simply were too fast or the slopes were too significant for the greens. When greens are faster like that, they need more water, they need more attention, more labor. Can you imagine if we could go back to having golfers walk on a green that were maybe only 8 or 9 on the stint meter and embrace that and say, I like that, it's a chance. And by the way, this thing with the yips, as we're reminiscing, I don't ever remember when I was younger. I can't think of one case in my mind when I saw somebody with the yips many years ago. Just didn't happen. As greens got faster, we're seeing the nerves come in. And you say to yourself, has that been good for the golfer experience? You know, it's interesting. As we were reminiscing, I was one of those people that happened to whip a persimmon wood. I remember wrapping clubs with leather grips when I was young. But it was interesting, is I heard John Bodenhammer and Thomas Pagel this morning talking about dropping over your back. There's a funny story that came to mind, is that I got hired by a gentleman named P.J. Boatwright years ago, and he was telling me, I asked a question early on, why did we change the rule where you drop over your back? And he starts laughing, he goes, well, he goes, in the early 1980s, he was working a senior women's amateur championship and got called out to a rule situation. It turns out a player was dropping over her back, drops the ball, and then couldn't find it. Looked forever. And then finally, they decide, PJ says, okay, put another ball into play. So later that evening, she's getting undressed, and she had a hoodie on, and it turned out the ball was in her hoodie. And that, I'm not kidding you, that was the real reason why why this got started. Anyway, I digress. I apologize. But imagine turf grass that can better withstand drought and disease resistance. We've come a heck of a long way in the last century. I know the USGA Green Section's been a big part of that, but we're not there yet. We'll continue to improve in the next century. Imagine an acceptance of golf courses that might use, I dare say, artificial greens. You know, it still would be a golfing experience, and it still may be the right thing in certain settings. Imagine a scenario where golfers were accepting of sand greens. Anybody in here ever play on a sand green? Man, it's amazing. I mean, when they're prepared right, they putt beautifully. When you hit into a green, they putt beautifully. And, you know, folks, there are certain places in the world, when you look at the cost of maintaining a green, the chemicals used on it, the mowing used on it, the aerification, et cetera, et cetera, you start to think, you know what, that's not such a bad idea. There's golf courses in the Middle East that are just pure sand golf courses, and you say, that is a golf experience. So this notion of a dark green overwater golf course maybe isn't the right way. And if you think that, you know, there's golf courses in the desert that use 250 million to 300 million gallons of water a year that they're pulling out of the aquifer. If you think in the future that that's going to be able to be continued at that rate, there's no way. They're going to have to figure out other ways to irrigate their golf course and where they're getting their water. So it's just golf will innovate itself. Imagine, you know, changing the mindset of architecture and also how golf courses are set up. So if we get to some of the things you heard yesterday, Bruce Charlton said it, of a wider golf courses with less force carries, golf courses where you can bounce balls into the green. Those are all things, I think, that really are innovative. It's almost a back to the future to improve the golf experience. Imagine packaging golf and offering golf in more than just 18-hole rounds or 9-hole rounds. What's wrong with almost packaging it by the hour or even by the hole or by the experience? I think that, you know, as we move through time, you're going to see more innovation in that respect. John Bodenhammer mentioned it earlier. Imagine a handicap system that really does consider the daily weather conditions. Imagine a world handicap system where players of varying abilities from around the world can play on an equitable basis. Stay tuned to those. Those are going to happen. Imagine virtually eliminating wait times. Now, I know that sounds almost impossible, but we don't think it is. We think technology in the future we'll get to the point where golf courses will really be able to run in such a way that the golfer will not, by and large, be waiting for golf shots anymore. Imagine if you're building a golf course or if you're renovating a golf course, having the ability to truly understand, before you ever put the shovel in the ground, what the experience of the player might be and what it's going to cost to maintain what you've just done. It's amazing how many times a golf course embarks on a renovation or building or a building a new golf course, and they just don't think about what the experience is going to be for a player and how much it's going to cost to maintain it. Think about this. Imagine this. Golf balls with an internal chip inside them where you don't have to look for them anymore. Right now, the rules of golf say you can't have that. That's not allowed by the rules. But think about it. How many people do we know like looking for golf balls, wasting their time looking for golf balls? That's an innovation we shouldn't turn our backs on. And last, I guess in this spirit of, you know, some of the things we just heard,
Can you imagine a concept of a variable distance golf ball? Think about that, variable distance golf ball. Think about any other sport. Have other sports allowed their equipment to influence their playing field the way golf has? I don't think that you can find another sport that has allowed equipment to dictate how playing fields get changed. I mean, think about baseball in the United States. If they were using titanium bats and a hot baseball, and they had to go to Fenway Park and say, move the big green monster out another 75, 100 feet. That's exactly what's happened in the game of golf. And you say, what good has that done? And I can't think of a good reason maybe it's helped, I suppose it's helped architects and it's helped construction companies that have done the work, but by and large, it's cost a lot of money. But if you think about this concept of a variable distance golf ball, think about it this way. If that was one day done and it was not mandatory, in other words, golf was given the choice to say, I'm going to fit a golf ball to the player, I'm going to fit a golf ball to the golf course. Imagine that a golf course could reduce its footprint, because we've seen footprints expand with distance, but you may see under that a golf course actually be able to reduce its footprint. If you reduce your footprint, what happens? Less input, so water, fertilizer, less labor, less mowing, less time to play it. Can you imagine an architect being able to come and say, instead of needing 150 to 200 acres, think about it, I've only got 50 to 100 acres, can I create a golf experience? You know, right now there's nothing in the rules saying you can't create a golf ball that goes shorter. We see at some practice ranges around, North America, that you are hitting reduced distance golf balls to keep the balls in the range. You've probably heard of the Cayman balls. These exist, but it's not, it's not a radical idea. Can you imagine players of different hitting distances actually being able to play the same teeing grounds? Would become much more social. If you think about it, we already bifurcate distance. Think about it. We bifurcate distance because we play from different teeing grounds. But what happens if all of a sudden I wanted to play with Dustin Johnson and say, Dustin, here's an 80% golf ball, I'm using 100% golf ball, and we're going to play the same tees. It sounds radical, but it might not. The other thing it might do is take some golf courses that have had their architectural integrity compromised, at least by some, and say, okay, Dustin Johnson, we're going to go play, whatever, Myopia Hunt Club, this wonderful golf course that's host four U.S. Opens back in the late 1800s and early 1900s, and say, I think maybe they can stretch Myopia out to 6,500. Throw Dustin an 80% golf ball and say, we're going to go play the back tees. Guess what? It would be a great experience for him, and he'd be able to play this wonderful, historic golf course that, by and large, he can't play anymore. So anyway, these are just some ideas you think outside of saying, how can golf think about the future? How can it innovate it for itself? Instead of mandating everything, maybe there's a way to give golf choices to say, if it's right for a certain golfer, if it's right for a certain golf course, we shouldn't shy away from it. I suspect everybody, if we took time, you'd have dozens of innovative ideas that we could think about, and I think that's important. I can tell you the USGA is very, very bullish and excited about the future. Despite what some in the media might write about where golf is, when you look at the data, we think golf is really well positioned and we think it's going to be strong. We're also would readily admit that there are things that we have to be focused on for the future. We've talked about cost and the sustainability of golf course. And by the way, I like the word sustainability, so I'm going to keep using it. But I think that is something that as we move forward, we have to be mindful of it. So anyway, golf has been slow to change, and that has a lot of good things about it. But at the same time, I think we all ought to be open to change and make sure that we're respectful of the future, but looking to the future generations to make sure they can play a game that's enjoyable like all of us had to do. So with that, I'd like to close and just say thanks to each and every one of you for partaking. This has really been a good day and a half. I think we got a lot of good ideas exchanged, and with that, I know we have lunch, so thank you for your participation, and safe travels home, everyone. Thanks.
early in the morning before work.
Chasing the sun at the end of the day.
With my daughter.
Or with my dad. Just playing nine holes is a great way to introduce people to the game.
It's an awareness campaign to just get the golfer to say, hey, instead of playing no golf today, maybe I'll just go out and play nine holes.
Come on, y'all. Let's play nine.
Buy your ticket to golf history as the game's grandest stage, the U.S. Open, comes this June to Erin Hills in the great state of Wisconsin. Limited tickets available only while they last. Visit usopen.com today.